So some of our faculties haven't joined yet, if I see, but we'll start nevertheless with our first presentation of the day, and that's going to be by Dr. S. Karthik sir. Karthik sir, could you share your screen and presentation with us? We are eagerly waiting. Thank you, sir.
Can you all hear me now?
We can, sir.
Okay, all right. So, good afternoon, one and all. It's indeed a great privilege to be presenting to the Nepal Arts Trophy. So, let's get into this topic. We'll talk about decision making in traumatic shoulder instability today, mainly concentrating on the anterior shoulder instability. So, I'm Karthik Selvaraj. I work in the Southern Indian city of Coimbatore. So we all know that there are three most popular surgeries nowadays being done for anterior shoulder instability. Those are the Bankart with Rumpelstiltskin, and the Lattice surgery. So these are the three most common surgeries being done. Now the French actually drive us on the shoulder front with their thoughts and with their studies and their results. So Pascal Boulot, Jill Walsh, and Christian Gerber, these are the people we follow from the European side. And these people have come out with repeated studies, and they conduct big meetings, and they always talk about Lattice being the one and only successful operation for anterior shoulder instability. This is because they've done a lot of long-term studies of their own patients, and they found that the Bankart surgery actually resulted in almost 50% failure rate. And they always thought that the results of Bankart are inferior to Lattice, and so they promote this operation, Lattice operation, very much in all their meetings and their publications. Now, the Americans have a different view. The Americans, most of the American publications seem to think that Lattice operation is not a very simple operation. It's an operation with a lot of complications. And the results of Bankart, as claimed by the French, are not as bad, according to the Americans. So you can improve the results of Bankart by using more anchors or using, say, double-loaded anchors, or adding another procedure like repairing the posterior labrum, or a Rumpelstiltskin, or closing the rotating tool, or some sort of additional procedure. So this is the thought of the Americans. So a lot of Lattice bashing happens in the American literature as well. Like the last January 2020 issue of Arthroscopy had an article which said that Lattice is being abused by a lot of people. So now, where do we stand? Where do we stand in this whole thing? The South Asian scenario is not very different. The Indians, Nepalese, I guess all the South Asian countries, we all belong to the same culture. And our culture is, we have a lot of athletes who are actually not the stars. They are not very financially sound. They come with traumatic anterior shoulder instability, and they want a very less rehab time, and they want to go back to their sport. That is one scenario. The other is, we have a lot of farmers, manual laborers who do heavy physical labor. Patients who also want a surgery without any care, and they want to go back to their work very soon. And again, finance is a problem. So this is our scenario. How do we choose between surgeries? As shoulder surgeons, as sports surgeons, we are faced with these questions. So the first question is Bankart repair a reliable, successful operation in the long term? Now, all the studies coming from Europe are long-term studies which claim a lot of failure for Bankart. That's the first question we need to ask ourselves. Is Bankart a good operation, let's say, at 5 or 10 years' time? Now, second question is, Lattice a dangerous operation fraught with a lot of risk and not to be done as a primary surgery, like the Americans claim? That's the second question. And the third question is, Lattice is such a wonderful operation, why don't we do it on everyone, like the French? So these are the three questions I'm trying to answer in this talk. Now, going to the first question, let us look at some of the long-term studies of arthroscopic Bankart repair. Now, this is a study published almost 90 early authors, and this is published by Ian Lowe's group. Ian Lowe is a very famous surgeon in Canada. Now, his results, like an isolated arthroscopic Bankart was used in our patient regardless of the bony defect. Now, post-operative, am I audible?
So you are audible, sir.
Okay. Now, the post-operative recurrent instability and arthritis rates were unacceptably high. So he found that almost 30% of the patients recurred at 9 to 12 years after band cut surgery. This study was published in 2017. So all the patients were operated before 2005. Now, at that time, we were not very aware of the bone loss problem in shoulder. So all the patients, irrespective of whether they had a glenoid bone loss or humeral bone loss, were offered arthroscopic band cut operation. Now, when you don't consider bone loss, the rate of arthroscopic band cut is unacceptably high, almost 50% according to this paper. And a lot of these patients also developed post-instability arthritis. So that's also a problem. So when you are considering a patient with shoulder instability, there are a lot of factors you need to consider. You can't do one blanket operation, which is arthroscopic band cut. So you'd not be doing arthroscopic band cut for everyone coming in with shoulder instability. That's the result of this paper. This is another European paper. Nearly one third of patients had recurrence of instability after arthroscopic band cut at 10-year follow-up. Again, this is a 10-year follow-up study, 30% failure rate. Patients aged less than 20 years actually had 50% failure rate. So this is the study again, published in 2018. All these are very recent articles. So these are minimum 10-year follow-up. Now, what we need to understand is arthroscopic band cut doesn't fail at 2 years. At 2 years, you take all the 2 year studies, the failure rate will be 2%, 3%. At 5 years, it's about 10%. But at 10 years, the failure rate is at 30%. So you need to really understand this. So this is a systematic review done by the British group. So the overall rate of recurrent instability in this group, arthroscopic band cut, was 30.2%, combining almost 8 studies which had more than any. So at 10 years, the recurrence rate is 30%. This is being proven again. And the overall revision rate is about 70%. So 1 in 5 patients will need another operation if you do a band cut operation. Now, again, if you look at instability arthropathy, the rate of instability arthropathy, patients developing arthritis after instability surgery, it's at 59.6%. Almost 60% of patients will develop some sort of instability arthropathy after your operation, after your band cut. So that's the result of this study. So answering the first question, now, band cut surgery, if it's a successful operation long term, we can say yes, it is safe and reliable, but you need to understand that at 10 years, at least for now, the results are like, say, it's about 30% recurrence rate and almost 17% acquired revision operation. So, what you have to understand is this operation should not be done in all patients. It cannot be done in all patients, especially patients who are less than 20, they have a very high recurrence rate. Bone loss, several other factors need to be considered. And also, what we need to keep in mind is there is a very high incidence of arthropathy. Now, second, whether it's dangerous. This is a paper published by Gary Gatzman. This is immediate and early complications of open lattice procedure. Doing complication rate was 5%. Hardware complication rate was 0.05%. And females actually had a very osteopenic bone. So the overall complications mainly were which required complete all these 5%, all the 5% complications were also mainly neuropraxia related complications. So as such, according to this paper, immediate and early complications are very less if you do a lattage. Now looking at long term, complications and reoperations of the Bristol lattage systematically. This is Grace's article, which is very commonly quoted. According to this study, the complication is almost 30%. Now, everyone who wants to bat lattage says there is a 30% complication rate after lattage. But actually, if you go and read the paper, it says, despite the complication rate, many complications do not require any revision or reoperation. Further, there are any lasting clinical consequences. So, there are no clinical consequences for most of the complications. They're minor, very, very minor hematoma or some sort of wound agent or prolonged dressing or something like that. Actually, very negligible set of very complications in systematic review as well. So, as said, it's not a very bad operation. Now, this is Jill Walsh, the master himself, followed his patients for almost 20 years, and he came out with actually looking at the hospital. Now, we all know that it's a non-anatomic operation. We are doing a coracoid transfer. It is not an anatomic surgery like band cut repair. No, we are always worried about what will happen to the shoulder in 20 years time. Will it become very arthritic? He looked at his patients, almost 70 patients, and then he followed them for 20 years, and he found that the arthropathy rate was 23.5%. So that's not much. And what he found was the older age at time of final follow-up, high demand sports, and lateral overhang of the coracoid graft were significantly associated with arthritis. So high demand sports is something which the patient does, but then the lateral overhang of coracoid graft is completely under surgeon's control. So one thing which you need to understand about latage is you need to do the operation properly. It's a, technically, you have to be perfect so that you can avoid all the surgeon-related complications in latage. So answering question two, there are no major complications for latage. It's around 5%, not very, mostly harmless. Technical failure is the problem. So if you have any technical failure, you don't do a proper operation, you break the coracoid, you don't place the screws properly, it can lead to breakage of the graft or non-union of the graft or lateral overhang of the graft. These are things which can lead to problems after latage. Arthropathy rate is about 25%. That's not much. It's almost comparable, or it's in fact less when compared to Bankart. So that has answered our second question. So what is the most most of the studies in literature that all the patients who have instability will develop some sort of arthropathy at 20 years. And the incidence is almost about 40-70% in literature. Whether it is surgery related or injury related, I think it's mostly injury related. Many patients before coming to us itself have actually backed their shoulders badly. Number of dislocations, age of first dislocation, whether they are into a very heavy sport or very manual job, all these things are important in deciding the incidence of arthritis. Again, bone block operation, if you do a bone block operation, now if you make the shoulder very stiff by doing a tenotomy and tightening the subcap very much, this can lead to ER loss, external rotation loss and stiffness, and this can actually cause osteoarthritis. If you split the tendon, there is no ER loss. So this is a small surgical step in latage. I think latage is going to be covered in the detail data. So tenotomy is not advised. You can split the tendon. There is no ER loss. Then the incidence of arthritis is very, very low. Again, lateral placement of graft is a strict no-no. So when you compare these two operations, latage versus bank, all these comparative studies, this is Pascal Bowlow's study. Again, in this study, he says that the rate of incidence in arthroscopic Bankart was 2 times higher than following the coracoid bone block procedure. So definitely, latage scores over a Bankart operation. This is another study, an Italian study. Again, this study, arthroscopic Bankart repair. This is a very interesting study. I'll come back to the study in a minute. Now, the systematic review or meta-analysis, this is done by John Frantalis from Sydney, Australia. Review looking at all studies comparing latage to Bankart, and he found that latage is definitely a superior operation with less number of lower amount of recurrence, and there is no significant difference in the rate of complications according to the operation. So other significant finding here in this study was rho score was higher and loss of external rotation was lower in the latage group compared to the Bankart group. So if you do latage properly, you will not have any stiffness. In fact, patients will regain movement much quicker than Bankart operation. So this is the Ian Lowe's another study as well, which says that regardless of what else you do, 15-20% of patients will have subject stability post. So Bankart versus latage. Latage seems to be superior to Bankart in terms of recurrence with no increase in complications, especially in young and elite athletes, young patients, very young patients, and also even in patients with bone loss as less as 10%. Now, usually the recommendation says any bone loss more than 25%, you have to do a bone block operation. But then there are all these studies are quoted that even at bone loss of 10%, patients feel subjectively much better if you do a bone block surgery. Now, this is the paper which I was talking about, Alan Barber's paper. Alan Barber is a strict arthroscopy man. He doesn't like latage that much, but then he now has changed his view that if you do a Bankart, you must have to probably add a remplissage as well, because that has now become a gold standard when you are performing arthroscopic Bankart operation. Now, but bone loss alone does not decide failure. Now, why does Bankart fail? You need to understand that we all think that glenoid bone loss or humeral bone loss is the cause of failure. But there are several other factors which you need to keep in mind, like labral quality. You know, the patient who comes after a first-time dislocation or a patient who comes after 20 times, you go in, the labrum is totally different. You don't find a juicy labrum. You find something like a very, very sorry labrum. It's a bad labrum, and you yourself don't feel confident putting it back. Now, patients who are hyperlax, this is another group where there is a enormous capsular wall. So you have to do something along with just an arthroscopic band cut in these patients, like tightening them at the back or adding a rumplicide. These are things which can take care of hyperlaxity. Now, too young at first dislocation, these are patients who are any, you know, these are patients, elite athletes, manual laborers. These are patients who are going to test your repair in the field every day. They are going to, you know, put your operation to test every day. Your operation has to actually pass every day in the test. So they will at some point actually will rupture all the good repair you've done. So these are patients you have to keep in mind that an isolated band cut might not be a good operation. So that's where all these scoring systems came, you know, the instability severity index. But it has been proven time and again that there is a very high observed variability and it's not a reliable predictor of failure. Now look at this labrum. Again, the top is the band cut and lower is the ALSA. Definitely, both are not going to give the same result if you do the same operation. And so we developed our own algorithm. This is the algorithm developed by arthroscopic band cut. This is our own algorithm for recurrent shoulder instability which we have developed. So this is so all the patients who come in to the hospital get a 3D CT scan. Now they get a physical examination. Batten is checked in them. So according to the Batten, hyperlaxity is scored. A 3D CT actually tells us about the bone loss of the patient. Along with an MRI, we get a 3D CT. So we calculate the glenoid index. The glenoid index, the bone loss talk is going to be just after this. So the glenoid index is less than 0.8. All these patients get a Lattice operation. The glenoid index is more than 0.8. And still, if the patient is a contact athlete or a manual laborer, he's going to get a Lattice. Now, these are patients, even if in spite of having a normal glenoid, we are going to give them a bone block operation for the reasons we just saw now, okay? And now, if the patient has a normal glenoid, but he has all these high-risk factors like poor labral quality, off-fractal sac, or hyperlaxity, these are three things which we consider as high-risk. If these patients don't have any of these, then they get an arthroscopic band cut. If the patient has any of these risk factors or more than one, they get an arthroscopic band cut along with the rumplicide. So the way we calculate the off-track and on-track is going to be covered later. We just used the Diaphragmatic method. And this is the study which we did in our hospital with the preliminary data for 80 patients followed up for 4 years. And that is the sort of distribution we have. Arthroscopic band cut with rumplicide, almost 50% of patients qualified for that. Only 20% of the patients actually had isolated band cut repair. So, in 2015, if you take our percentage, we must have been doing almost arthroscopic band cut repair for almost 80 to 90% of our patients. The Lattice incidence was only 10%. But now the Lattice has gone up to 30, arthroscopic band cut with rumplicide has gone up to 50, and isolated band cut is only 20. Now, we followed up these patients here. They had excellent results. None of the patients have actually dislocated. Very minimal complications. One patient had a superficial hematoma. One rumplicide patient in the initial stage actually had severe stiffness, but he recovered quite well at 6 months, so we did not do anything for him. So, I would like to conclude that we follow an a la carte approach for our instability patients. So if a patient who comes to you who's a sedentary office going male, no hyperlaxity, good labral quality, minimum or no bone loss, then you can straight away go ahead and do a band cut repair in this patient. You don't need to worry at all. Now, if a patient is very young, now if the patient has poor labrum, intraoperatively you see the labrum very bad, now he has an off-track heel sac, or if he has maxillary hyperlaxity like high Batten or a dry through or a Gagey, then this is the patient whom you should add something to your band cut. So the best thing to add is a rumplicide. It's a very safe operation to do. It's a very simple, straightforward, quick operation to add to your band cut. So it just gives you this additional insurance. It's like an insurance policy you take for your operation. Now, if the patient is a hard worker, manual laborer, contact athlete, severe glenoid bone loss, if it's a revision procedure, if he doesn't have the money, then I think the best operation is the Lattice. You're not losing anything. You're not by doing this operation. It's safe, very reliable, almost 99% successful operation in all these patients. Our understanding of shoulder instability over the past 5 to 6 years and evolving. And now the last question is answer what you do the Lattice in all patients. Now this is a very good paper by Jill Walsh. Contraindications. There are certain contraindications for Lattice. You can't do it in all the patients. The French are now you know, realizing it, they tried to do this operation on all patients and they have had failures. And when you fail on a latage, it's a problem. You don't have a salvage. So your salvage is not good. So patients who are hyperlax, for example, latage is not a good operation. You have to do something to tighten their capsule. Just by putting a bone block in the front is not going to solve the problem. If the patient has got a cuff tear, obviously latage is not going to work. So these are some contraindications which you have to think in mind. Again, complications, talking of complications, you have to keep in mind that surgeon is the most important factor there. So you have to put your coracoid in the right place. That's the most, most important thing. Thank you very much. Thanks for this excellent opportunity.
Thank you, Karthik sir. It was an amazing presentation. Now I would like to request our panelists, if they have any queries or they can unmute themselves, and if they want to add on something or if they want to post any queries, you can go through, sir. Our panelists, Dr. C.B. Misra, Dr. Naveen Karna, Chakra sir, and Arjun Shrestha sir. Chakra sir, yes, you have unmuted, yeah. Sir.
Yes, I did. Thank you, Dr. Karthik. I just want to, open a little discussion about sort of a Bankart, you know, the study that you have shown. Since in India and in Nepal, you know, the group of patients we deal with, they are of the type of, not the type of the high elite sports people like in Europe and, you know, America. And our, you know, quotations are mostly from our, you know, literature, documentation are mostly from those countries. So, you know, like in my own experience, redislocation rate, although we don't have hundreds of cases to show and follow up, but the type of 1/3 of the population having dislocation after, you know, regular Bankart repair is just not like that. Although my own practice was about now 20-30 years. So the point I wanted to bring to this, to your notice is, the group of people we are dealing with, not exactly the type of the people, that is being dealt in other countries, the countries in the Western countries. That's one point. Second thing is, you mentioned about Ramprasad has been, the Ramprasad and the Bankart has been a gold standard. And there is, you show that in your one of the pie chart, there is a huge number of Ramprasad followed by the Latarge and then the Bankart. So the issue about the Ramprasad is the dynamic testing. This question to you is that dynamic testing is done before Bankart repair, right? Is that right? The engaging and non-engaging issues of the heel sacs is done before the Bankart repair. Is that correct?
I'll answer the question. Are you done? Or
I will come to you, but you can follow from the first one, first my comment, and then to the, then I will follow.
Sir, thank you very much. Actually, the issue you raised in the first is absolutely, I totally agree with it, because we don't have any Indian literature. We don't have any Indian or South Asian or Nepali literature for that matter to know the long-term follow-up of our patients. Now, the problem in our patients, we in our institute, we do see some of the patients coming back at 5 or 6 years with recurrence. Now, most of our patients are not elite athletes, as you say, that's right. And culturally, when somebody gets an operation done, they immediately don't do any high-risk activities. They go away from doing any high-risk activities. But the sportsmen are a different category. You know, for example, a national-level boxer or a volleyball player, or a basketball player. These are patients, they're going to go back and use their shoulder. But majority of our patients are going to be very careful after the operation. Usually for the first 2-3 years, they don't do anything. Their shoulder feels absolutely normal. At the 3rd year or 4th year, they go back to start playing, or, you know, they ride their bike and they fall down. And that's the time they dislocate the shoulder again. So we are seeing some late recurrences in our patients. And that's why we wanted to add something to the Bankart operation we do. And then we, as you said rightly, in Europe, most of the surgeries are done after the 2nd or 3rd episode. But here the patients come very late. I say they come after 5 to 10 dislocations. That time their labrum is very bad. When we go in, as you might have also experienced, many times we find a very bad labrum. And that's the time when we think, maybe, in addition to this labral repair, if we just add a anchor at the back on the humerus just gives us an additional support. So that hasn't failed. In our study, we have found that if you add a rumpus arch even in a patient who has an on-track defect, it has worked quite well. That's what I want to tell. The decision to do the rumpus arch is on the CT, we decide if it is off-track or on-track. And inside, we don't go and check for engaging or non-engaging at all. So once you see if the patient's labrum is bad or if he's hyperlax, and when you see a Hill-Sachs lesion, you just put an anchor there. You finish the take the bites first, and then go and come and do your anterior labral repair. So as some people do, you do your bank heart and then check for whether the humerus is engaging or not. I think we are putting too much stress on our repair by doing that. So we don't do that. We actually do the rumpus arch first and then do the bank heart. We tie the knots later. We tie the knots at the end.
Yeah, okay. The reason why I wanted to bring this discussion is that's the reason why Glenn White on track or off track concept came, because of this problem. Since there is a like a CT, you may think about that, and people thought about the dynamic testing during the surgery, and when they found that before bank card repair, since you cannot do the rumpus arch before you repair the bank card, it will be difficult to look into and evaluate that Hill-Sachs lesion. That's the reason why you put your anchor initially in the the Hill-Sachs lesion and then tie it after you do the bank card.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
That's what you do.
Yes,
but
yes.
If we were able to assess whether this is engaging or non-engaging Hill-Sachs lesion after bank card repair, maybe the percentage of rumpus arch would have decreased. That's what I wanted to make a point. Since we cannot do that, the number of cases being reported in the literature about rumpus arch plus bank card has been much higher.
Okay. Because of time constraints, that will be discussed in the subsequent presentation also, sir. We'll continue with that. Some other panelists who had any questions, sir. Naveen, sir, quickly, sir. We'll take one more question. Amit, sir, was also raising a finger, so I'd like to ask that also. And Dr. Rajiv, sir. So first Naveen, sir, then Rajiv, sir, and then we head to Amit, sir, and then we start with our next presentation.
Dr. Karthik, very nice presentation. I just wanted to know that, as you said, for the contact athletes and who has to do overhead activity like volleyball and badminton, you offer first time as a letter J. I just wanted to know that in our day-to-day practice, almost all of us has to do some overhead activity, even day-to-day activity, to pick something from height or like that. So this activity is done by almost all of us. So why are you distinguishing these two groups? If that is the trend, then why not to go for lateral for all the cases?
So that's what I said. This elite athletes and manual laborers, they do most of the work up there. So if you have a volleyball player, a national level volleyball player, we can't compare ourselves to him because he's always hitting the ball there. So he always wants to block the ball up there. So his arm is mostly at this level. So, and for a boxer, say, I've operated on a national level boxer, I've operated on both sides. He had a lataje done on one side and then he came back to dislocation on the side had and gone back to playing. So for them, the amount of force required and the amount of activity they do at this level is high. It's not like us. For us, it's one. So for a software engineer who wants to play badminton or tennis in the weekends or even every day for half an hour, it's a different thing. But for the player, he'll be playing all through the day. He'll be playing, he might play 8 hours in a day. So that's his demand is more. He will be testing your operation every time he plays. So that's the thing I want to say.
Yes, sir. Rajiv, sir, please unmute and ask the question, sir.
Yeah. I just want to make a comment. I agreed with Karthik, because nowadays we are getting a lot of patients with recurrent multiple episodes. We don't get the patients with single episode in our part of world. Because of recurrent dislocation, as we all know that labrum get atrophied and we get a big Hill-Sachs lesion. And looking at that, we also know that our patient also require a stable shoulder. Looking at the labral quality, if you put rumpus arch on that, I think it gives a more stable shoulder rather than concerning with any non-anatomical procedure. And I'll come in my lecture about this overuse of replicas with the dynamic examination. Thank you. Thank you. This is all.
Thank you very much.
Nagmani? Okay, so it's my turn. Nagmani, something has happened to his maybe internet. So before I start my presentation, let me launch a poll. Okay, this is a poll. Can you see a poll there coming into your screen? Can everybody see?
Yes.
Okay, there are six questions. Please, you have 2 minutes to finish them off.
I'm not being able to submit.
You have to go down and try to submit it.
Yeah, I've filled the points, but pressing on the submit does not submit.
Okay. So, but some people are already able to. I can see that there are 14 already submitted.
I've been trying.
The question, last two question, the question seems very similar. Did you want to say the Hillside and the glenoid?
No, it's maybe some printing mistake. It's not glenoid, it's Hillside. So last two is for the Hillside.
Here it was showing both as glenoid.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, five and six.
Yes.
It is not glenoid. It is for the Hillside, humeral head bone loss.
Humeral head bone loss.
I got it.
Okay. So may I ask question to Vivek till we are having this poll going on? Dr. Vivek Pandey, when do you decide that you are going to do a remplissage in this particular patient? How you decide pre-op and how you decide, do you decide it intraoperatively?
I think, Amit, the pre-op is based upon, one is a radiological parameter. If my radiologist has reported off track, then I would do that. Okay. Second is, so if it is off track, or I can say it is very close. See, today I saw one patient who is son of my, one of the OT in charge. Okay. And this boy has got 5 dislocations in last 3 months. The first one was a fall while playing something, and then after that 4 has happened. Now his glenoid bone loss is 11%. Okay, his the Hill-Sachs index is 16 mm and the glenoid track is about 18 mm. Do you understand now? You see, okay, the glenoid track is 18 mm but Hill-Sachs index is 16 mm. It means I have only 2 mm left. Now definition wise it is an on track lesion. Okay, but I know it's just 2 mm. And Chakra Rasar was also talking about something dynamic. See, other day in last discussion also I said, see, it's just 2 mm. So what if there is an error in radiology? And what happens, especially while throwing activities? Okay, the very same thing which is borderline on track can actually become off track. So these patients who are frankly off track, where the Hill-Sachs index is very close to the off track, I will still do. Younger patients with even medium bone loss, you know, medium size Hill-Sachs lesion, I will not hesitate. Somebody who has been a bit lax shoulder, I will still go ahead. So the definition, you know, Amit, it is still not very categorically clear. But I keep my options.
Amit sir, should we start now, sir?
Okay. So what I see here is almost everybody say that probably out of 40 result we have, 50% say they do always. Okay, so if you want to just sharing with your result, just go through this result and we'll come to this later when we present mine.
Okay. So we move ahead, sir, with our next presentation, and that's by Professor Amit Joshi. He'll be talking on evaluation of glenoid and humeral bone loss, why it is important. So, Amit sir, please begin, sir.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen.
Yep, sir.
Okay, am I visible?
Yes.
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay, so probably this is one of the very basic questions that many of our colleagues are thinking about, that why it is important to evaluate the bone loss and how actually to do this is my topic. So if you see, the world of shoulder instability surgery is divided into two groups. One group, they do Latarge, the French group, where probably Karthik is standing at this moment. And the other side is the Bankart group, where Vivek Pandey and people like me are standing. And we are very proud of a new technique, relatively new, which is Remplissage, which we think that if we supplement with this, probably the results are going to be better. So the division is made by practically by the bone loss and some other issues also, but bone loss is the main indicator for deciding what type of surgery is going to be done. So why it is important is there is a concept of a critical bone loss. So critical bone loss means the amount of bone loss which will definitely impact on the decision making and the functional outcome of a particular surgery. So if the critical bone loss is less than the desired, then there is a low recurrence rate of Bankart repair and there is a good functional outcome. But if the bone loss is higher than the critical bone loss, then high rate of recurrence with the Bankart repair and poor functional outcome, and probably a Latarge procedure has been debated for all these patients. So what is the critical bone loss? As we saw, Karthik was showing his critical bone loss was glenoid index. He said 0.8, that is how he decide. That means for him, critical bone loss is about 20%. There are Easy Itois and some other paper who say that critical bone loss is about 25%. So 25% who will decide either to go ahead with the Bankart repair or with the Latarge procedure. This is a little old, and then subsequently after this, there are some other papers also. So this is redefining the critical bone loss. And this paper says that it is not the 20%, it is not the 25%, probably a subcritical amount of glenoid bone loss of about 13.5% also have a poor, more than 13.5% also have a poor outcome with the Bankart repair. So one important thing is the bone loss that everybody has to measure, that many of the surgeons they suggest. So when we talk about measuring the bone loss, you can measure in the glenoid and you can measure in the humeral head as well. That means a Hill-Sachs lesion. And there is another concept. So if you combine this humeral bone loss and with the glenoid bone loss, then this gives a concept of a bipolar bone loss that I'll also talk about. And then this will give rise to the on-track and the off-track concept of the Hill-Sachs lesion. So how to assess the glenoid bone loss? It can be assessed in X-ray, it can be assessed in the CT scan, and it can be assessed in the MRI as well. And of late, many people are assessing in the MRI. This is a X-ray, which was a Bernaggi view, which is used to be done. I'm not going to this one because I don't believe that many people use this to assess the glenoid bone loss. The most commonly done is the CT scan. So there are values of two-dimensional CT scan and there are values of the three-dimensional CT scan. I'll not go into detail, but CT scan by and large at this moment is the gold standard for the measurement of the bone loss. So how to measure the bone loss? Karthik was also saying, Dr. Vivek was also saying that glenoid index is one of the most commonly measured index in the CT scan. So this is a picture, this is a 3D picture. I'm going to show a video how to measure the glenoid index. This is right and the left. So to measure the glenoid index, basically you need both sided shoulder. So you need a right side shoulder as well as left side. So this is important to know that when you advise or when you recommend for shoulder, you have to suggest to take a on-foss view of bilateral glenoid. Then you mark the superior glenoid tubercle and the the apex and draw a vertical line. Once you have drawn this vertical line, mark a point which is junction of inferior two-third and the middle two-third, and at that point you draw a perpendicular line to the previously drawn line. So this is a perpendicular which is about 31 millimeter. So you do the same thing on the other side. Two points, one is the supraglenoid tubercle and the inferior one. Then again the mark the junction of the inferior and the middle two-third, and then draw a perpendicular line to that, and you measure this thing. So it will come around, so 21.9. So once you have this both measurement of both the side, you can calculate the glenoid index. This is 21.9 divided by 31. So this will give rise to a glenoid index, which is in this particular case 0.7. So how you can calculate a bone loss from this glenoid index is, so the normal glenoid width was 31, the affected side the glenoid width was 21.9. So that means there is a 9.1 millimeter of the bone loss, and this 9.1 millimeter is about how much percentage of this 91% of the 31 normal glenoid is about 29.35. So this is the way you can calculate a glenoid index as well as the bone loss in that particular shoulder. My favorite technique is a perfect circle method. This perfect circle method is easy because you don't need to do a MRI of the other side and doing a CT scan of the other side on first view. The only affected side will be enough. So here I'm trying to show the video. You mark same the point, the superior glenoid tubercle and the 9 o'clock position in this side. So you make a perfect circle which touches the inferior pole and the 9 o'clock position. So this is the perfect circle that you have created. Now you can measure the whole diameter. So this will give you a normal width of the glenoid, the supposed to be normal width of the glenoid, which in this case is about 4.2 centimeter. And then you can measure the loss part. So from the edge of the glenoid to the edge of the circle. So this will give you about 0.7. So once you have measured this, both the loss and the present, then you can go and calculate your bone loss. So 0.7 is lost, and this is about 16.66% of the 16% of the bone loss. So this is a perfect circle method. The third method is a PICO method. Again, in this method, this measures the volume of the loss, and this requires a CT scan on first view of the bilateral shoulder. So how I do it? So first you measure in the normal side, you need a both the shoulder 3D reconstruction on first view. You put a perfect circle. Yes, please.
Can I interrupt you for a while?
Yes, go ahead.
The line method, which you took from top to bottom, and the, you know, the ratio of the width, and then the circle method. You were showing on screen, how are you doing? Are these the same patients?
No, these are the different patient.
Okay, because it looked the same, because what I understood, you see, when you do the circle method, the chance of error is very high.
Very true.
If you do the line, compare with the other side, the much more closer.
Very true. So I'll come to that. So you take a circle from the normal side, and then you take you put it on the affected side at the same size circle, copy and paste, and then you can mark this empty area. And this your software of the CT scan computer will calculate the volume of the loss. So this part of the glenoid is lost, and then using those things, so how much volume is lost from the glenoid and the total volume of the glenoid, then you calculate your bone loss. In this case, it is 26%. So coming to the humeral side, again in the humeral side also, you can measure in the X-ray, you can measure in the CT scan, and you can measure in the MRI also. I have no experience of measuring all these things in MRI. The CT scan by far is the best. If you read the Bolleau's paper, when he said that ISIS scoring system, he said that probably if you can see the Hill-Sachs lesion in external rotation, that is a significance. That say that probably an X-ray can also be used to measure or quantify the Hill-Sachs lesion. These are the X-ray technique, which is known as a radius technique, by which you can measure all these things. I'm not going to that, but My and the easiest technique is known as the funky pizza technique. So in this funky pizza technique, you create a circle and divide this circle into 8 slices. So each slice means it is 12.5% of the bone. Now, you take the CT scan where your Hilsa's lesion is the largest one, the cut of the CT scan where the Hilsa's lesion is the largest one, and then you paste your funky pizza out here. And then adjust so that it matches with the circle of the head. And now you can see that this is one slice of the pizza, which is about 12.5% of the bone loss. There are so many things. Some have given a classification. This is Bigliani's classification, in which they say that if there is less than 20% loss, it is mild, moderate, and severe. And probably if there is more than 30%, they need treatment. I don't know this based upon just the CT scan. Coming to the bipolar concept, bipolar is a very interesting concept. If you see this first X-ray in which there is no bone loss, but there is a Bankart lesion. So if there is a Bankart lesion, that means there is no anterior strain, this Hilsa's lesion is going to engage. But if you repair the anterior Hilsa's, anterior Bankart, probably this Hilsa's lesion is not going to engage because there is an anterior strain. Now, even after repair, suppose that there is a bone loss on the glenoid side. So even if it is repaired, the bone loss will create such a situation that these Hilsa's lesion will engage. And this is the concept that not only the bone loss into the glenoid side, but also bone loss into the humeral side is also important. And this is the concept developed by Easy Itoi and the group, which is known as the bipolar lesion. So what is the glenoid tract? A study done by Yamamoto, they say that the glenoid tract is a contact surface into the humeral head of this glenoid. So in their study, they said that about 80% of total width of the glenoid comes in contact with the humeral head. And this contact area is known as the glenoid tract. So if you consider this is the glenoid, this is the glenoid tract, and this is the Hilsa's lesion. If your Hilsa's lesion is within the glenoid tract, then they are known as the on-track Hilsa's lesion. If your glenoid lesion is outside the glenoid tract, they are known as the off-track Hilsa's lesion. And this is the basic concept which many people nowadays use to decide either to do with what to do with the Hilsa's lesion. Another important thing we have to understand that if the glenoid is normal, the same Hilsa's lesion may be on track. But now you see the same picture. Now this shows that if there is a bone loss like this, the same location, same size Hilsa's lesion, if it is associated with the bone loss, then this becomes a off-track lesion. And this is the very important concept that has to be understood. So how to measure the bone track, the glenoid track? And again, I need 3D reconstructed film on first view of both the glenoid and the posterior aspect of the humerus where you can see the Hilsa's lesion. So how I measure is I again do measure the width of the glenoid. So this is the normal side. The width of the glenoid on the normal side is 24 millimeter. Here it is 22 millimeters. So now you can see that the bone loss is about 2.1 millimeters. So this 2.1 of 24 gives rise to a 8.5% of the bone loss. So now the glenoid width of the bone loss area is 22.6. So 84% of 22.6 give rise to you a figure which is known as 18.76. So glenoid tract of this particular patient or that shoulder will be 18.7. Now what you do is you draw the Hilsa's lesion, you mark the Hilsa's lesion, and put your 18.7 into here. So now if it falls within the tract or the Hilsa's lesion is within this region, that means it is on track. Or if it goes outside, then it is a off track lesion. So as Vivek was also trying to say that how this can be simplified, if your glenoid tract is more than the Hilsa's lesion, so in this particular case, the glenoid tract is more than the Hilsa's lesion, probably these are on-track lesion. If your glenoid tract is less than the Hilsa's lesion, so you measure from the footprint to the medialmost border of the Hill-Sass lesion. If this is less than the glenoid tract, probably these are the off-track lesion. This is how you can measure the on-track and off-track. And based upon that, there are treatment paradigm that has been given again by Giovanni, Itoi, and Burkhardt. You can decide what type of surgery will be suitable for that particular patient. However, before concluding, these are 2020 paper in which they have doubted what is the accuracy of currently available method in quantifying anterior glenoid bone loss. And unfortunately, they say that there are various methods and its accuracy cannot be judged. So we cannot say that which one is the best method by which you should measure a glenoid bone loss or a humeral side bone loss. This is another paper, a very recent one, 2019, says that the measurement of bone loss may not be very useful because this may not be accurate and the critical bone loss we have not yet defined. So it may not be very useful. So coming to the end, this is just like an anticlimax when you say that there are so many methods, there are so many ways you can measure. And at the end of the day, when you come to know that probably none of these are very accurate and sharp, so we are lost and we don't know what to do. So to conclude my presentation, I would like to conclude by saying that bone loss is only objective criteria which helps us in guiding the treatment option. So at this moment, we do not have other good criteria except the bone loss. There are various methods of bone loss measurement exist, and none of these have shown significant superiority over other. So probably using one or two odd method may be a good idea to do, and probably we'll listen from our panelist which will be a better one. Although estimation of bone loss is very important for decision making, it is not the only factor. So other factor also has to be taken into consideration when you talk about the bone loss. So this finishes my presentation. Thank you very much for patience listening, and hope there will be some question to discuss. Thank you, Dr. Nagmani, if you are there. Otherwise, Vivek, you can take it further.
Thank you, sir. That was an amazing presentation. I would like to tell that we'll be just entertaining a couple of questions directly to our presenter. And after that, any questions which you want to ask to Dr. Amit, you can post it in the chat. He'll be personally answering it to them. So we hand it over to panelists, sir. Please raise your finger when you want to add in something. Yes, sir. Arjun, sir. Please.
Sir Amit.
Yes, Arjun.
Can you hear me? It's a very good in detail presentation. Thank you very much. So I have some query that because there are lots of factors deciding whether to go Bankart with Hill-Sass or the open lateral J procedure. So you are doing most of the cases. So what is your the recurrence rate after lateral J and Hill-Sass in your cases? And the other thing, the next question is, because in Nepal, in our scenario, because we are afraid of the recurrence. So once, because patient with their financial problem or any other things, so once the patient will be treated, we are afraid that they will come again with the same problem. So generally, there is a tendency in our mind that we generally go for the absolute kind of treatment. So we know that the lateral J and Hill-Sass has a good outcome, but if recurrent will come, maybe 3 times or 4 times, generally our tendency will become automatically that we'll do the bony procedure, so that the patient will not come to us complaining of the recurrence chance. There is a problem. So I think you have also encountered this problem. So what's your recurrence rate after lateral J, Hill-Sass, this procedure?
To tell you very frankly, we have collected about 171 cases that has been done over 4 years. And then touchwood, since we have started our Hill-Sass, so probably 80% of all my Bankarts, they are supplemented with Hill-Sass. So with Hill-Sass, and then there is no significant bone loss. My cutoff mark is again 20%. If there is a less than 20%, I'll attempt to do a Bankart with Hill-Sass. If it is more than 20%, I do not suggest, usually do not suggest a Bankart procedure is a lateral J procedure. So probably, and then Vivek's paper, there was excellent, and there are so many other paper coming up. Dr. Rajiv Gupta also trying to say that if it is supplemented with Hill-Sass, because something there is anteriorly, and probably you give some capsular attachment from the posterior side, it will not only disengage the engaging lesion, but it's also provide some capsular tightening from the backside. Probably that helps on reducing. One point I would like to highlight that nothing will compromise the quality of the surgery. A poorly done Bankart in whatever good patient will not work. So the technique has to be correct. The capsular shift has to be correct. The anchor placement has to be good. The anchor, the selection of the anchor has to be good. The knot tying, knot security, knot strength. So this is more technically deep. Probably many people say that Latarge is more technically demanding. Actually, if you do a proper Bankart and the remplissage, probably Bankart repair is more technically demanding in the other thing. So probably everything is done correct. Lesser. Yes, Vivek, I can see you raising hand. You can go ahead.
Thank you.
Yeah, Amit, I think you raised the one of the most valid point, and I'm thankful that you had to say this, that lethargy should not become the procedure of escape. You know, the most important thing in the recurrent instability surgery, do the surgery. A large number of people follow this, that when the bone losses only exceed, you supplement the bone only when the bone is gone. You have a bone loss of 5% and you want to put another big bone block thinking that this is how I'm going to prevent the recurrence. Probably these are the things, if one starts coming to your mind, then you don't develop the good arthroscopy skills. Nothing can substitute. And we have been doing, and you know, fortunately, both of us have been collecting data now for a large time. A good bank card, good release, you know, solid capsular shift. And then if necessary, you know, supplement with the remplissage. I'll just quote one paper. It is a paper by Nagakawa. All of you can read. It is published in AJSM 2015. And I have quoted in my paper. According to Nagakawa, you see, any time when it is a bipolar lesion, bipolar means when you have a Hill-Sachs lesion, any Hill-Sachs lesion always engages. You know, that concept of Burkhardt, when there are some non-engaging Hill-Sachs lesion, that is a very funny concept. I have never been able to understand forever. For according to him, if there is a Hill-Sachs lesion, it has always engaged. And Nagakawa, he says that if you have a Hill-Sachs lesion, it is, you treat it as a bipolar lesion. And if necessary, you know, he goes very radically saying that you do the remplissage, though I don't agree with this completely. But a good Bankart, a very good Bankart, if necessary, supplement with remplissage. Trust me, your results are almost comparable to the Latarge. Because, and it will be another 5 years when many and many papers will come. You see, what is a systematic review or what is a meta-analysis? It is a review of, it's a pool of all the data. And you're pooling the data right from 80s and 90s and probably 2000 when the techniques were not perfect. Absolutely. So let's see what the meta-analysis of Bankart and remplissage compared with Latarge in another 10 years or let's say in 5 years. So if you do a good Bankart remplissage, it almost matches with the same. But yes, if bone losses are more than 20%, go ahead and do the Latarge.
Okay.
Any more questions? Vivek, can we ask just a question to all the faculties, especially from India? Yeah. What percentage of their Bankart is associated with remplissage? Just in numbers. Just guess.
Well, sir, Rajiv, sir, we start with Rajiv, sir.
Okay. Now, previously, way back, 5 years back, I used to do only 10%. Now it is more than 30-35%.
Rajiv Raman, sir.
30-40% now. 30-40%. And as
Vivek, sir. Vivek,
mine is, I can say it almost inches to 80-90%. I don't hesitate. And I will tell, this is the genesis of my paper. After I've started doing remplissage from 2012, my recurrence rates are near nil. You know, it's, you know, only 3-4 have fallen, and that too, they are drunk, they fell down in the ditch, all those things happen. But otherwise, they have just, and all of, not everyone is an elite, but there are a lot of people who play overhead sports and they have not dislocated.
Okay. Probably, Karthik, sir, you're there?
Yes, Karthik, yes.
Yes, so as I told, my percentage is almost 30% primary Latarge, 50% Bankart with remplissage, and 20% isolated Bankart.
So somewhere ranges between 30-90. So I got carried away with the message that if there is a Hill-Sachs lesion, probably at some point of time, it is just matter of what degree of external rotation and abduction, but at some point of time, it is going to engage. So this is a very important fact. So if you see a remplissage, there is no harm on aggressively attacking that remplissage with one odd anchor, and then probably, and then you see the 2019 and 20 papers. They are saying that the recurrence rate are at par with the Lotarge if it is associated with compressage.
Okay. Naveen sir, one last question, and then we proceed. And then the last one is going to be Dr. Bibek Basukala. Naveen sir, quickly, sir.
I just wanted to know, Dr. Bibek, that if the Hill-Sachs lesion is maybe less than 20%, then if you had done a very good bankart repair, make a good bump, then that on-track, that off-track lesion is not going to be converted into the on-track lesion, number one. And as you said, that it's just only the how much external rotation you do, there is a chance that on-track is going to the off-track. Then if you are doing the latter J also, then also you suggest in all the cases you go ahead with Liam plus Haas.
I'll start from the last question. See, Naveen, there are some situations and there are some places where people are recommending for extremely large Hill-Sachs lesion, you do the Lat-RJ with emplissage. Okay, but those surgeons and those, probably those are very few, because in Lat-RJ, you are giving a much more larger area for the ball to roll. Okay, and according to them, the Hill-Sachs, you know, does not come into the play for engagement. Can you repeat the first part of your question, which I probably did not understand properly?
Yeah, first part, less than 20% bone loss is there in Hill-Sachs. And when you are making a very good bankart, making a big good bunk over there, then you are not converting the off-track into the on-track. So we are no more using
this percentage thing in actually in the Hill-Sachs anymore. The current philosophy, almost everybody is using the Hill-Sachs index or the on and off track, because it's extremely difficult to measure this percentage. It's actually the part of the head, and it's extremely difficult to measure by any technique. Yeah, I can try this, Amit, so maybe the pizza size technique, but off late, I mean, we have not been doing this.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, fair enough. Vivek, quickly, and we move. Dr. Vivek Basukala.
Okay, Aman. Sir, you have mentioned in many techniques to quantify the glenoid bone loss, you need to have bilateral shoulder CT scan, right, sir? So, can we take that both the shoulder or both the glenoid are equal size? Is it always like that, or both the glenoid are of different size?
This is a very important, and then you have to talk to your radiologist so that they give the same magnification of both the glenoids. So when you put into the CT scan, it is not only one shoulder is taken. Usually both the shoulders are taken. You don't need a small cut and the 3D reconstruction of the whole case. You know, you just need a 3 picture. You talk to your radiologist, they will give it very easily of the same.
No, sir. What I meant is we project the perfect circle in the normal glenoid and get that circle over the abnormal glenoid.
True.
So that means, can we conclude that both the glenoid naturally is always equal, or there is some morphometric variation?
There are so many studies. It has proven that probably both the glenoid size will be almost of the same size. Yes.
Okay.
Can I quickly add something? I think Dr. Bibek has brought in a very good point. See, the size of the glenoid is the same on both sides. But the latest research, the paper published in 2019 and this year, they are looking at the concavity of the glenoid. You know, the cartilage makes a concave surface. Now, Philip Moroder and his group and others have published that the concavity of the normal side, the undislocated side, varies when we compare to the dislocated side. So in the future, it will not only be the size of the glenoid defect. We might be also measuring the concavity using some 3D images. Yeah. So it's a good thought. I think we still have to understand a lot on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Karthik sir. Now we quickly move to the third presentation, and that is by Dr. Rajiv Gupta sir. And he will be presenting on what are my indications for remplissage. Rajiv Gupta sir, kindly share your screen, sir, and presentation with us. Any more questions, you could put it on the chat, and Amit sir will happily answer those. Thank you.
Good afternoon to all of you. Thanks a lot for inviting me on the PAL Arthroscopy Association platform. I think previous speakers all half of job done by them. It's make me a little bit easier. And now at present, we are all convinced that we have to keep ourselves a little bit more relaxed to keep add on good bankart repair, because our patients require a stable shoulder for better function. I start with the case history. 46 year old male with right dominant hand. First episode 1.5 years back while doing job work in his shop. In between 3 and 4 episodes, last dislocation 2 months back in night. And all tests as usual are normal, no laxity, nothing. Rotator cuff examination is normal. And this is what his x-ray. What is important in this is dislocation in night. That gives you something like it's the problem is more than it's a soft tissue lesion. Maybe it is a bony side, might be it's on the humeral side or maybe on the glenoid side. This is what his picture. He has an EPSA lesion with big hill sacs. Now, still in best of end, we have 20% bankart fail in spite of all good repair. And why? As we discussed, all already done, glenoid bone loss, hyperlaxity, quality of tissue, of labrum, and your profile of patient, again, and engaging hill sacs lesion. All depends, all matters a lot for your success of the surgery. And most of cases in Burkhart and DeBeers in 2000, 67% of failure in their series is because of large hill sacs lesion or glenoid bone loss. And we are still not know what is the subcritical, what is the best to measure, or what is the critical size of hill sacs lesion, whether it is a depth, it is a thick width, we don't know still, but let's see. There is a lot of various methods of measurement that Professor Amit already discussed. I just come to know, I want to highlight on arthroscopy. Joint repairs and Burkhart suggested that we should do intraoperative dynamic evaluation. But the problem with this is it gives rise to over-diagnosis of hill sacs lesion, because without repairing Burkhart, it gives no anterior restraint and leads to more anterior translation of humeral head. This concept of engaging and non-engaging lesion is just the hill sacs lesion get engaged and it leads to leverage of the humeral head out of the glenoid in spite of repair of Burkhart lesion in functional position, that is abduction and external rotation. What the Burkhart and DeBeers is, if your this hill sacs lesion is parallel to your glenoid, then this is going to engage in the abduction and external rotation, not in the neutral position. And if it is diagonal to your glenoid width, then it is not going to engage and your Burkhart repair is sufficient. But in the paper in 2014 by Itoi, this is more reproducible, more reliable. I think now we are all doing following this on track and off track lesion. What is important is the location of the hill sacs lesion, not is it a depth of the lesion. If it is how far from this insertion point of cuff to this area. If it is far away, that shows that it is going to engage it. What I mean is it's off track. See, this is a bony bridge in between the insertion, that shows that it is more medial on that size. This is going to engage. This is off track lesion, and this is close to the insertion area or bare spot, that is going to be off on track lesion. This is what we discussed already, how to measure it. Glenoid crack, it is 0.83 divided by diameter and minus defect of the glenoid. This is what the glenoid crack concept. If your glenoid crack is more as compared to his sex lesion, it is an on-track lesion because it is not going to engage over the anterior glenoid rim. If it is a bone loss, then the glenoid tract becomes smaller and this same lesion is now becoming a off-track lesion. The difference between this Itoi and the Burkhart is they suggested dynamic examination after Burkhart repair. But the drawback was because you are going to overstress your newly repaired capsule labral complex that can compromise your surgery. This is what we discussed already. We have to repair first your Bankart, then do the dynamic examination. If it is engaging, then you go with the Remplisas. This is how I do. You just put your calibrated probe and find out where is a bare spot. For example, it's the posterior two is 15 mm, anterior is 10 mm. What I mean is 5 mm, approximate 5 mm bone loss is there. Now you divide, do your calculation to find out your glenoid tract. 0.83 divided by 25 minus 1 is around 15.51. Now you assess your width of the Hill-Sachs lesion from the insertion point of cuff. This is called, we called it bony bridge. Then 12 mm width of Hill-Sachs lesion and 12 mm of bony bridge. It gives rise to 24 mm of Hill-Sachs lesion. This is what I mean is it is more than your glenoid tract and it going to engage your anterior glenoid. This is called off track lesion. Now we have various ways to treat Hill-Sachs lesion. We have bone grafts, some disinfections, arthroplasties, partial humerus, head resurfacing. We have Weber's osteotomy, those more morbidities, more open infraspinatus transfer like McLaughlin procedure and open lataryngeal, arthroscopic lataryngeal again to enhance, to increase the articular arc length. I'm going to discuss with arthroscopic Remplisas. This is given by Wolf in 2014. And what is Remplisas is just, it's a capsulo and capsulotasis with tenotasis of infraspinatus. You just fill in the defect of Hill-Sachs lesion, and this reduces intra-articular lesion to extra-articular. And of course, you provide posterior capsular tightness or restraint that helps in decreased translation of your anterior, decreased anterior translation of humeral head. And this is how you can secure your Bankart repair in a much better way. Remplisas for large Hill-Sachs defect with normal glenoid, or if you have bipolar lesion with glenoid defect like 20-25%. This is some arthroscopic picture where you are supposed to put your anchor suture. This is how you are not supposed to keep your anchors close to bare area. It should be somewhere close to articular surface or in between that. This is some entire pictures. Just here, I want to minimize my presentation and share with you my some videos. This is how I measure my, this is Hill-Sachs lesion. It's a big lesion and anterior is a ELPSA type of lesion.
Rajiv, we are not able to see your video. Please.
It is not visible?
Not visible.
Okay, I'm trying to share again.
First you close your presentation.
Now it's okay? It's okay? No, I have to close my presentation.
Now it's okay.
Okay, then I have to go again. Now, this is what my probe is coming. This is a bare spot, and I can calculate my posterior glenoid, which is normal, and by assessing this, how far I am from anterior and posterior. This can I reproduce, I calculate my glenoid tract and I can apply on my Hill-Sachs lesion like this. One more I have. Can you, it's visible to you? Can you see my video?
No, sir, you haven't shared your screen. Kindly share your screen, sir.
Okay, okay, I'm doing that. It's just... just give me some time. I have to stop my presentation first and then I'm going to share with you. Now this is what I did in this. This is with anterior Bankart with Remplisaz. This is post op follow up. There is a little bit restriction of axon rotation in non right side. This is what that he said. It's a Pipper and Wolf in 2014 that showed that at second look arthroscopy it got healed in the lesion in the fracture, and again MRI also shows that well healed infrasmatous tendon in the insects. There is a lot of concern about shoulder pain and restriction of axon rotation. Am I audible, Dr. Amit?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In initial follow-up up to 1 year, there is a mild restriction of axon rotation and patient complain of posterior shoulder pain. But with the long term, after 2 years, the complaint of restriction of ER and shoulder pain get reduced. And we are agreed that if patient has stable shoulder, then it is much better to give them a shoulder with little bit restriction of movement rather than giving a recurrent failure of surgery. My post-op rehabilitation is I immobilize them for 6 weeks, and in between I allow them for once the pain and swelling goes down, pendulum exercise, allow them to eat or drink, and just instruct them to avoid axon rotation and abduction and flexion above 90 degrees. I start active assistant range of motion exercise after 6 to 8 weeks, isometric isotonic strengthening exercise after in between 3 to 4 months, and contact sports after 9 months. There is a lot of literature now. Nowadays we have a lot of meta-analysis, as Dr. Vivek was discussing. We have a lot of meta-analysis, lot of literature regarding arthroscopic Bankart with Remplisaz. This is latest in 2019 in ENA. No recurrence in Bankart Remplisaz group as compared to Bankart group. There was around 4% of recurrence, and it is an effective method for restoring joint stability at 10 year of follow-up. It is a big follow-up, and I think it's a maximum follow-up of Bankart with Remplisaz. Wolf and General of Shoulder and Elbow Surgery 2004. It is an effective approach in bipolar lesion if the lesion is of third A, or what I mean is less than 20%. They found only 4.4% recurrence in such type of patients. This paper in 2018, it's again a meta-analysis, only 1.4% of recurrence in their surgery and it in their group. And this Bankart with Remplisaz provide more stability, 4 times more as compared to isolated Bankart repair. Again, arthroscopy 2012, better function, diminished pain, satisfaction in more than 85% of patients. Similar, there is a paper in American Journal of Sports Medicine 2018. We don't think that lethargy is the everywhere. It is not a blanket surgery. For off-track lesion, SX lesion with subcritical glenoid bone loss, this paper says Bankart with Remplisaz is much better as compared to lethargy, and lethargy should be reserved for failure of your soft tissue surgery, or if you find that your patient is high demand with collision and contact athletes. In summary, arthroscopic Bankart repair with Remplisaz is an ideal effective method for a big SX lesion. You can combine with bipolar lesion if glenoid bone loss is less than 20%. And pain and restriction of external rotation is not a concern in long-term follow-up. Thank you for patience hearing.
Well, thank you, Rajiv sir. It was an amazing presentation, sir. Our panelists, anyone who wants to ask a question could raise their hands. Chandra sir, please unmute and ask. And yeah. Even our other presenters, if you have any question, that will be followed by Rajiv Raman sir, and then we'll subsequently move, sir.
My small question is to all the arthroscopic shoulder surgeons. How many of you will change the decision when you go through the arthroscopic look of the shoulder joints? Because sometimes in a knee case, sometimes we have to change the decision making. So how many of you will change the decision when you go through the shoulder joint?
Regarding the choice of surgery, either you do Bankart from Latarji Okay. Okay, so...
First,
take.
I think it's a very, it's a vast, if you are planning a bank card and going out for Latarji, it's very, somewhere there is a lack of planning. If you plan it in a better way, proper way, I think it is very clear cut for indication for Latarji and arthroscopic bank card. If you on MRI, you find your good bank card, your patient is not so chronic with 20-25 times of dislocations, I think you can come up with your bank card, good bank card. And still your doubt about the, and your CT MR scan is radiologist is good enough, and they recommend about the glenoid bone loss. I think very for us, it is not like that planning a bank card and going to Latarji. It's all depend upon pre-op planning, your patient profile, and quality of tissue is the last one you can find out.
So practically you do not do that. Okay. Rajiv Raman?
Yeah, actually with newer imaging modalities, I think it's quite easy to plan your surgery because the CT scan and MRI. The only thing sometimes once I was planning for Bankart or convert to Latarji, it was a poor labral tissue, which you cannot assess very well sometime in MRI. But in, I think most of the cases you can plan before with your good image modalities.
Karthik? Karthik, what is your take on that? How many times you have converted your Bankart to a Latarji? Intraoperative decision.
Once.
So Vivek, your take on
that? Yeah, I have converted twice. Because the, as Rajiv said, the only thing which is very difficult to assess is quality of capsule, and it is so paper, such a paper thin that nothing will work. So, you know, some days, okay, then you...
Surprise, the patient might say that he has dislocated only once or twice. MRI might not show, you know, about the quality of labrum. And sometimes patient is so young and you want to go in and you find nothing there, in nothing to put in front of the... In those cases, maybe the only option is... But it's a very rare thing.
Absolutely. While I was going through the paper, I also read that the number of dislocation and the quality of the tissue, they do not match. The labrum may disappear. The capsule will remain. So they do not match. Actually, we actively have to identify, except the bone loss, what are the other features that will tell us that probably a Latarji is a better procedure. Yes, Vivek.
Amit, even the bone loss doesn't match. You know, sometimes we had patients who had only two or three dislocations. Then you thought, okay, beta CT, you know, CT not required. Okay, yes, come with MRI. And inside you go, you realize, oh my God, it's almost close to 17%, 18%. Yes, it was not definitely 25, but for three dislocations, four dislocations, you don't expect. So now if it is a second dislocation, you know, some if my resident will call, I'll say, okay, do the CT. Because, you know, once bitten, twice shy. You don't want to change your decision on table.
Sir, can I ask one to all the presenters, sir? Rajiv, sir, please go ahead, sir, and then I'll ask. Rajiv Raman, sir.
Yeah, Rajiv Gupta, what is your take on whether you should go for a capsular only rempislaw or a capsular with a cuff part also, infraspinatus?
I took infraspinatus with capsule both, not only capsule not.
So what Vivek does actually?
Vivek boss?
I think there's one Chinese or a Korean paper where, or a Japanese paper where they have described to take only the capsule, but I don't think, you know, I'm so much qualified that I can separate it. The only thing is that I don't go for too medial. You know, once you put the anchor, you see actually that what level you have put the anchor. Don't go too far medial. Just take the bite at that level, maybe a little, a millimeter lateral, that's all. Because if you take the bite too medial, whatever it is, whether it is the capsule or, you know, the infraspinatus tendon, I don't know. It's extremely hard, I think, because they're all merged. If you see the capsule is always merged to the fourth and fifth layer of the tendon. So I don't know, when I read that paper, I was like surprised. How have they done that? You know,
My just a quick question to everybody. How many of you, while doing remplissage, go to subacromial space and see where your knots are sitting, either it is taking a infraspinatus or not?
So there is a paper where they've actually dissected the specimens after doing the remplissage, and they found that actually we're not taking the tendon, we are actually taking the muscle. So we call it capsulomyotis rather than capsulotenodesis. And for your question about going into the subacromial space, for the first few phases we did that, but after that I'm doing it blind. I don't go into the subacromial space.
Actually, among the leading surgeons, it is the Sugaya who does that. You can tie it in that. And then Karthik, there's another paper where they have done an ultrasonographic study, and they found that often, especially if you put the second anchor, you know, a bit lower down, you're actually denodizing the teres minor.
Yeah, so in 40,
you're actually infringing onto teres minor.
So I remember Vivek uses only one anchor doubly loaded, whatever size it is.
99% of time.
99. Rajiv Raman, you were different because we saw Rajiv Gupta most of the time two anchors. Karthik, how you do it?
I do one anchor most of the time. In very, very large skin sack, then I do two.
It's doubly loaded, right?
Double loaded, single anchor.
Okay, Nagmani, go ahead.
Well, sir, the last question. Rajiv, sir,
you wanted to say something? Dr. Rajiv Gupta?
Regarding subacromial space, I tried once when I just followed this double pulley technique of Bacard. Otherwise, now after that, I just, it's a blind procedure. It's just, we are just thinking that it's going to put the knot will go over the infraspinatus.
Agree. But not absolutely blind, but from inside you see that your capsule and your tendon is coming and sitting into the Hilsa's lesion.
Yeah.
Okay.
5 years back, when we started doing this, I just want to say this, because for the first couple of cases, after taking the bite, tried going to the subacromial space, couldn't, because it's quite lateral, it's very difficult to go in. And then I actually did a mini open and then tied the knots for the first 2-3 cases. So you can still do that. It's not a bad thing. You can actually just give a small incision. You can feel it and you can tie the knot, because you're so scared that you might catch the deltoid or something else. So slowly, when you start doing more and more, then it becomes very, very easy.
Yes,
thank you, Dr. Vivek.
There is a small technical tip to that. What you can do is, if somebody really wants to try, you know, I've done it in initial 3-4 cases and I gave up. So when you put your anchor, you know, the minute you have put your anchor and you know, you are, then don't remove the holder, anchor holder and the metal sheet. Next, straight away you go to the subacromial space, clean up everything, because as long as your sutures are inside the metal, it's safe. You can burn, you can shave, you can do anything. With the sounding technique, you will hit the metal. That you can shave all it around, clean up the whole area. Now you go back, you take all your bites, and then you can come back and tie, because now you will see the sutures. If you have already taken the bites all around, now you'll have no guts to put your shaver or bar or you know, the radio frequency device, because you don't know what you're going to shave. So you really want to try, put the anchor, don't remove the metal holder, let it be there. Go to the surgical space, clean. It's nice experience, you know, have it once or twice. Okay.
Nagmani, let me summarize that. Let me summarize by saying that at this moment, the Bankart repair is very often associated with remplissage, and remplissage is probably one technique that every arthroscopic surgeon should learn. So rather than making it complicated, going into the subacromial space and trying to find it out, it's so easy that you put one anchor at the center of the Hilsa's lesion or towards the articular cartilage and doubly loaded, and just you see from inside, take whatever you get, either capsule, muscle, whatever you get, make sure that some soft tissue comes and sits and fills the Hilsa's lesion. And then that's where, once you are ready to do that, you have done that, and you can go and explore into the subacromial space. But most of the surgeons, they do not do it. But I've seen like Hiro Sugaya and some other people, they're going inside subacromial space and trying to tie it, making sure that you take the infraspinatus. And probably there are no studies saying that taking infraspinatus has a better outcome than not taking it. Okay, anyway. Fair enough, sir.
One last question. Since the presentation was regarding the indications of Remplisa, sir, I would like to ask the respective presenters. So apart from the bone loss and engaging and non-engaging, what are your other indications of having a Remplisa, sir? Presenter, sir, feel free, sir. Apart from bone loss, is age a factor for your Remplisa? Is the athletic level an indication of your Remplisa or not, sir? Quickly, sir, and then we move ahead with the next presentation by Vivek Pandey, sir. Yes, sir, Kartik, sir.
As I covered in my presentation, poor quality labrum, intraoperatively go and see bad quality labrum. That is one thing. Hyperlaxity, if you see a drive-through sign, from the posterior portal, if you can see the posterior labrum and posterior capsule very well, that means the capsule and the labrum is quite voluminous. So if you have to shrink the volume, we used to earlier we used to take a bite in the glenoid, put a posterior anchor in the glenoid itself. Now you can do that on the humeral side because you got the addition of the cuff there. So hyperlaxity, poor quality labrum, and of course soft track heel sac.
Okay, sir. Anything else? Rajiv, sir, all of us agree with that, sir. Those are our indications.
Yes.
So we move ahead with the next presentation, and that is by Vivek Pandey, sir. And it's going to be interesting. How do I do a bank cut repair? Tips and tricks, sir. Vivek Pandey, sir, please proceed with your presentation. Any participant having a question can post in their chat group, and subsequent presenters will address them. Thank you.
So my screen is visible, Amit?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Amit and team and the entire team for, calling me back again for the interaction. Now, as Amit, you pointed out a very valid point that, a good bank card is the key. It's the lethargy surgery should not become a, escape route that, can we do the lethargy, the recurrence rates are same. No, bank card, by and large, if we leave apart the Remplisage, which is, yes, technically speaking, it is not the anatomic procedure, but yes, we always don't have everything in our hand, but at least in the front, you can do anatomic work. And worse come worse, in the due course of time, if it fails, let's say 5-10 years or whatever, you can always do the lethargy. But if lethargy fails, then we are in trouble. Okay. So as we always remember, the most important thing about any bank card.
Vivek, your picture is too big, so we are not able to see it very nicely. It's a little too large.
So, okay, let me just see. Just let me see. Stop sharing. Let's see. Speaker view. Share screen. Problem. Is it still the problem, Amit? Hello, Amit?
Not yet, sir.
It's okay to us.
You can make it full screen, sir. We can see it, sir.
Okay, no, go ahead.
It's okay, you can see?
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. So the most important part of any arthroscopic procedure, whether it is the shoulder or knee or for that matter, any area, the portal is the key. Your portal establishing should be the key. So after finishing off your posterior portal, you need to have the idea of where are you going to place your antero-inferior portal, where are you going to place your antero-superior portal. And sometimes you might have to do the remplissage. So for that, the portal is slightly lateral to the typical, the posterior portal. It will be just a little lateral. And sometimes you have a, let's say the posterior labral tear, then you have to have the 7 o'clock portal, which comes here. And rarely you have a slap tear. So your portal might come here, or you might end up using the Nebbiaasier portal, which is here. So the absolute idea of all the portals is important. And unless you do comprehensive, the entire labrum, which is sometimes torn. You go inside, you have thought, okay, that the labrum is torn in the front. But when you go inside, you also realize that the labrum is torn at the back. And once in a while, you get the labrum on top. And rarest of rare situation, you will get a global tear. You can't come out saying that, okay, I put 3 sutures in the front and my tear is, the repair is over. So the idea of portal is absolutely essential, as pan-labral lesions are not uncommon. You will find once in probably 6 months. So the typical, for a typical antero-inferior lesion, you establish two portal, that is antero-inferior portal and antero-superior portal. Antero-inferior portal is always, so if you see, this is the left shoulder in the lateral position. So I do all my instability cases in the lateral position. This is the head of humerus. This is the glenoid. This is the anterior labrum. This is your biceps tendon. And this is the subscap coming. So for the beginners, you have to divide the subscap in two halves, the medial half and the lateral half. The first portal, which is antero-inferior portal, is always in the lateral half, where it is just skirting the just above the subscap. And before you make a portal, you place your needle and you should see. So let's say this is the glenoid, imaginary glenoid. Your needle must reach somewhere around 530 or 6. If your needle is struggling, if you are struggling with needle, you will struggle with your portal. I remember this dialogue or this statement which was made to, you know, which was told by Sanjay Garude about 10 years back. I was discussing something. He said, Vivek, if your needle, you're struggling with needle, you'll struggle with the portal. So ensure that your needle is perfect. And then next goes the antero-superior portal, which is just adjacent to the biceps tendon somewhere here. Some people make it anterior to the biceps, but in some cases you will find that there's a lot of, you know, these two tend to converge. If they are converging here, you will fight. So in that case, you can actually put it on this side of the biceps tendon. But more you come towards the bicep tendon, you are actually onto the anterior border of the supraspinatus. So try to be on the other side only. A lot of people continue to see and see from behind, but over the years, I think a lot of us have been, you know, shifted our scope to the antero-superior portal. So you shift your scope to antero-superior portal, but you can do from behind, that is the posterior portal and the antero-inferior portal. So it's always better to do it like this and then see from the top. Because when you see from the top, the ALPSA lesion are very, very easy to see. You can always see that how deep you have gone. Have you damaged the labrum or not? You know, how well you can, you know, elevate it. So some cases, sometimes we have a posterior labral tear. So this is where your posterior labral, you know, the portal comes. It is a bit lateral to the, also known as the port of Wilmington. This is this lateral to the, this posterior angle of the acromion. Again, the needle, what you see, it should go almost 60 to 70 degree. Because if you are too parallel, you'll skive off. You are going to skive off. So don't try to put your anchors through the traditional posterior portal. If you have to repair the posterior labrum, you have to place a separate portal. Remember, in all arthroscopies, you can make X number of portals as long as it is safe and you're not violating any major neurovascular zones. Don't be shy that, okay, I have to do only in two or three portals. So this is the typical posterior portal done for the 7 o'clock. I mean, for the posterior labral tear. Remplissage, so if you see from top, and if this is my, here it is. So if this is the typical posterior portal, the 7 o'clock portal will be here, and the remplissage portal comes somewhere in between if I have to do both. Okay, so again, you put your needle first, see that it has gone almost perpendicular, again, not in a skiving fashion. No anchor should be in a skiving fashion. As long as possible, it should be perpendicular on 60 to 70 degree. So that's how you make your remplissage portal, which is just lateral to the posterior portal. Slap, you have the, so slap again, you can have the portal from here. That is the antero-superior portal, this one. And this usually, if you carefully watch here, it is coming through the musculotendinous junction. Means when you enter here, don't try to come, through the tendon. You should go to the musculotendinous junction, because even if you make a rent in the musculotendinous junction, it is going to heal. If you make a rent in the tendon, it is not nice and it will make a huge rent. And you know, some people say that they may have persistent pain. All right. So bites, you can take the bites for the slab, the typical slab, which is existing probably here in this place. You can take the bite either from the front portal, that is antero-inferior portal, or you can take the bite through the Neviazer portal, which is somewhere here. Now, why I brought in the posterior labrum, why I brought the slap, because rarely in some situations you will have all these combinations of lesion, and you must know in which order I must do. So I'll go back one. first you should always finish the slab, because that area in the due course of your 1 hour surgery becomes a bit blunt. You know, there's a lot of edema coming in. Somehow the cuff sometimes comes down, so you'll not be able to see fresh. The slab is seen best in the beginning, right in the beginning. In 1 hour time, it will be completely obliterated. You'll find a lot of difficulty. So finish your slab means prepare, put your anchor, take the bite, tie, done. Then you shift your scope to the anterosuperior portal and you can finish the labrum first, posterior labrum first. Why posterior labrum first? Because just imagine this is your glenoid and you're seeing from top here. When you put your sutures for, let's say by chance you have put your, in this picture, I have already put my sutures for the remplissage. Now you want to do the posterior labrum repair, your sutures will come like this. It will like, you know, Spider-Man's cobweb. So that is why you finish your posterior labrum, finish, tie, finish it off. Then you go to the remplissage, put your anchors like in this picture I have put your anchor, take the bites and leave it. And now go to the front and finish off your Bankart procedure. Tie it, come back, and then tie the remplissage. Because if you tie the remplissage sutures right in the beginning, the problem is you will find a lot of difficulty in maneuvering your posterior portal because you have reduced the space. Nothing much will happen, but why to, you know, always keep that posterior rail a lot of vacant. So this is one tip. If you have to do these multi lesions, in which order you should do. Person may have their own personal preferences, but I usually follow this order. Repair of all additional lesions is absolutely essential for superior outcome. Now, this is what, again, I would say, if you are, you know, tuned only that I have to do only the latage, you know, you will not even put your scope inside, you know, because a lot of people want to do in a semi-inclined beach chair position. You will just do that and you have not even seen what has gone inside. Now, what are the key steps into the Bankart? Because that's the main talk about. So you start with, first you probe the lesion. Finish the slab, finish the posterior labrum, place the anchor and bites for remplissage, don't tie. Next, you shift your focus to the anterior-inferior labral lesion. You do the adequate release. Sometimes, in fact, quite often, I extend the lesion maybe 1/2 o'clock, sometimes 1 o'clock, because you have to really shift the capsule. Prepare the glenoid margin using the curette, sometimes burr, sometimes shaver. Place your anchor. 3 is essential, usually. Rarely I put 4, but 4 is extremely rare. I mean, you know, out of probably 50 cases, 2 or 3 will require 4, but most of the time it is 3 anchors which are required. You can use single loaded or double loaded. Adequate tissue bite. And when you take the tissue bite, it is important that you must, the inferior anchor in the Bankart repair is the key. This is where I have personally failed, because I have revised not many, but few of them I have revised. I realized that there were hardly any bites. The anchor was quite proximal. So probably if you have taken a quite proximal, you have not taken a proper bite, and these Bankart repair will fail in just 4 to 6 months or a maximum of a year's time. Poor tissue. If you feel that the tissue of the patient is poor, you may require the Mason-Ellen repair or a lasso loop technique, which I'll show. Sequential tying means sometimes we tie from top. If you tie from top, you actually shift a little bit more the inferior capsule. This is what we call not to shout shift, and finish the remplissage. Typically, you need the 3 or sometimes 4 anchors. It depends upon lesion to lesion. The inferior most anchor I personally have been using for last almost 10 years, double loaded, because my inferior most bite will go to the inferior most capsule and then this bite comes here. And then after that, these are all usually simple bites, depending upon lesion to lesion. Sometimes if I feel that this is also not very nice, so I'll use it as a Mason-Ellen bite. And this again simple. All these combinations, as you do more and more, your mind will tell you that, okay, this is what I need to do. Again, as Amit said, a very good repair is required. You know, the first repair is the best repair. If you do it well, nothing can substitute a very well done Bankart repair. So you do put the remplissage anchor, you know, suture passage, Bankart repair, and then tie the remplissage suture. So let's see a simple scopy. And this is the a left shoulder. Patient is in lateral position. And the scope is now in the anterosuperior portal. Okay, so this side is the posterior side, and this is the anterior side. Okay, so let's start from here and see. So this is the diagnostic arthroscopy. You can see it's an ALPSA type of lesion. The labrum has really gone below. This is a margin part of the labrum probably and part of the probably cartilage. A bit, capacious joint. As Karthik was talking, it's a bit capacious joint. Debriding the lesion first. Whatever is loose, flappy, you have to take it off because it has no, relevance. Next is we elevate the labrum. And see, this is where if you're seeing from top, it's very easy because I can always see that how far down it has gone. And my, Krish, and my, the elevator is going parallel to the labrum. See, sometimes if you're seeing from behind, you can actually go perpendicular. You can cut the labrum. You can cut the labrum. Just give me 1 second. Apologies, these are the perils of the sitting at home. Sorry. So then you elevate the labrum. So sometimes I use radio frequency, and sometimes with the help of radio frequency, I go a clock ahead. You see, I'm going a bit clock ahead here. I would say that some of you may have a doubt that am I close to axillarium? No, axillarium is about 1.5 centimeter. So you can use this radio because the extension of lesion can be done either by the radio frequency device or you can also use the scissors. Arthroscopic scissors are there, so you can cut it. But I find often, off late, I've been using radio frequency diet because it does it very neatly. Scissors, sometimes it's a bit blunt and it tends to chew the whole thing. So the whole thing is elevated, and once you elevate, you must see the subscap below. And then now the margin curettage for the bleeding edges. Just probably half a millimeter of cartilage you need to remove because the soft tissue has to sit over the bleeding or a nice raw bone. You can finish the remplissage and come forward. This video, I have done this front part first and then the remplissage. So this is, you see, this is what should be the goal. Okay, let me just go a second back. This should be the goal. Here you see the labrum is floating at the level of the glenoid without any effort. If you are doing an effort, like your labrum is still down and you're holding with some kind of a forceps or the grasper, then probably your release is not good. And here you saw initial the lesion was still here, but I have gone till here, almost something like 6 o'clock. So you elevate the lesion a little extra. When you take the bite, it's a phenomenal repair. And then we shift our focus to the backside. That is the Hill-Sachs lesion. Now it doesn't look very huge. It was a moderate size, but since this was this is a new technique which we have developed. It's patented and we are now going to publish it in the journal. So we are doing the intraop measurement using the special needles which we have developed. Now there's the preparation of remplissage. So again, put a needle which is a bit lateral to your portal. Just use the rasp to make it a bit bleeding. Sorry, Rajiv, I'm just showing once because it's a part of the video. Then take a single metal anchor. I've been using this metal anchor for a very long time, sometimes 3.5 mm or sometimes 4.5 mm, depending upon the bone quality. So single anchor goes perpendicular, close to the margin as Rajiv was showing, and somewhere in between the lesion, neither too posterior nor too anterior, somewhere in between. And here the thing is, what you need to understand is it has come through a single hole. The anchor has come through a single hole. So you need to take only 2 bites, one blue from there and one white from here. That's it. Okay. Because it will create a tissue here and a tissue here. So you can tie. You need not to take all 4 in different areas. Sometimes I do take, if I find that the quality of tissue is not good, then you create a parachute kind of a construct, something like this. Otherwise, one bite there, one bite here, that's it. So this is the bite through the tendon. And you see, I have not gone too far medial. Because if you come too far medial, it is just, you see here, I'll show you one more thing. You see here, this level is matching almost with this level. Okay, now if the Hill-Sachs is here and you take the bite here, means you have taken a huge amount of infraspinatus tendon. They will end up with a lot of stiffness. So don't go too far medial. That is the catch. Okay. And this I will tie at the end. And now we come back to this here. You see the lesion has been elevated here. The first anchor, you see the angle is about 60 to 70 degree. It's not exactly at the edge, not exactly on the face, somewhere in between. So you place your first anchor, and this is a doubly loaded anchor. Nagamani, is my video running fairly okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It's running, sir.
Okay. So this is the first anchor, and my personal technique, preferred technique, is I have always used a double loaded anchor. So you'll see a double loaded anchor here. And in this, I'll give you a tip. So you've got a double loaded anchor. So my first bite will be here, and the second bite will be at around 45 degrees. Now, first bite, you can't use any instrument from the anteroinferior portal. It's extremely difficult. So you have to take an instrument from the posterior portal. And what you'll take, you take a suture passer. Which suture passer? This is a left shoulder, use a right suture passer. If it is a right shoulder, use a left suture passer. And this bite, which is at 45 degree, which is the usual crucial bite for everybody, almost all of you use the suture passer. I'll show you how I use the expressive device. Now, most of the companies are making their bank cart scorpion, so-called bank cart scorpion. So I'm going to remove the sutures from here, because in Hindi, I mean, anyway, most of you can understand in Hindi, they say, ek mian mein do talwar nahi honi chahiye. There should not be two swords in one case. Okay, you have too many sutures in single portal, especially cannula portal, you can be in a disaster. So I've removed those remaining three. And now the left shoulder, right suture passer is coming in. How you can actually hold this? You see here, how am I holding the inferior most labrum with the help of a suture grasper or a suture retriever? Hold it, because when you take the bite, it should not float. If it swings, you'll be in a lot of trouble. So you hold it there. And you can see the tip. Once you see the tip, the same instrument will pull out this chia wire and you can shuttle it. And this is the key bite, one of the key bite, because it goes very inferior. Next, I'll pull out one of these type sutures from the front and I'll load it on the expressive device. And you see now, so my other instrument, this instrument is already sitting there. You can use a suture retriever or you can use a suture grasper. Either of them is fine. And now this instrument come. Now this expressive device or any rotator cuff device, which is actually designed for rotator cuff, but does not make a difference. It has got a jaw of 18 millimeter. Imagine the amount of bite you take, which is extremely difficult you take if you take with the traditional suture, the suture passers. A concern sometime, some year back, some senior rows that you are very close to axillary nerve. I'll tell you, I've done anatomic dissection. You're very far from axillary nerve. Okay. And hundreds of bank cards we have done. They have never a problem. Only thing is that sometimes with the help of this, actually you can elevate the whole thing, then see under your vision and then grasp. But trust me, friends, you are far away from axillary nerve. You got to be talented to damage the axillary nerve. So again, you see how am I holding it? Go farther. And it's just a 30 second job. You never ever struggle in this. Take this, hold, pull, over. You see the amount of bite you have taken. This is the key bite. Now, if you mess up this step, you have got a poor bite in this step. Don't expect to have a great results. Okay, if your key bite, that is the inferior most bites are poor, it's a failure in just 6 months time. Now, in this particular case, I'll show you the bites. The next bites are with the help of the knotless anchors. So that was with the knotted. Now you see the knotless. So in knotless, what you do, you can always pass the sutures prior. So I'm holding it. You see the holding with the suture retriever is so good because this thing doesn't swing. The labrum. Take this, load the suture outside. Suture is loaded. And now I'm going to put my knotless anchor here. If I tie before, then, it comes onto the margin of the glenoid. So sometimes it's very difficult to see where exactly I put and you have a tendency to put it more on the face. That's the reason I have, you know, put this first. Now I'm going to tie the rest of them. Look at this. Look at this amount of shift you get. Very easy. You know, it takes away most of your stress. The suture passers are excellent devices, but they can, you know, they can inflict a lot of mental torture on the beginning of your career. So that's the first one, this one gone. And then posterior one, in inferior one, sometimes I tie from behind because I find it more straight, you know, because when you tie from the top, the head of humerus comes in the middle and it hits the your knot pusher hits there. You see, look at this. Okay, and now I think I have put one more on the top because I felt that it required. So that's a different issue. So this is three anchor, in fact, four bites because the inferior one is the double bite. Okay. And now from here, you see, once you have finished the anterior bank card, you will realize after this, you just focus and try to recollect when we were putting the bites for the anchor and bites for the implicit, we had a lot of space. Once I finish here, you realize that the space reduces. That's another reason why you need to place your anchor beforehand. Because now if you want to place your anchor and have a bite, the space is actually very less. So let's see this. So from here, we go at the back. So this is the completed bank cut repair. Good, nice, juicy labrum. You have created a huge bumper. And now we go at the back and now you see suddenly the space is not exactly the same what we had before. And now you tie the, you know, the, as Rajiv was saying, this is usually the blind method. Only thing is that by tying, you should see any puckering of the skin. If there's a puckering of skin, probably you have taken the deltoid, okay? So that we tie and this is the completed bank card repair with Remplisar. So this is like day one, you have given the best possible. Beyond that, I don't think I can do anything better for him. Now, what is not shift? Not shift means, you see, again, this is one patient where, you know, the labrum quality was not looking very good. It's almost a straight line here. Straight line means almost a 14 to 15% loss. So usual, all the steps are there, but we start tying from top. And when you tie from top, this is one step that you hold with the grasper and pull it above and then start tying. So that gives you about a millimeter of shift. This concept was initially actually, you know, initialized by Sugaya. He has never, you know, said it too often, but it was, I saw him actually in one of the conference or somewhere, probably I went to him, there I learned. So this is what is known as a knot shift. And then you start tying the below. But this is only when you have done probably 40, 50, 100 bank cards and you're very, very good in managing the suture. Don't try in the beginning because you'll get confused. And then you can tie the lower ones. So this is how, you know, the final almost looks like. You see the final repair. Okay. Sometimes your sutures, the here, okay, sorry. Now here the superior most tissue quality was not very good. It's not exactly very nice. I just did this a bit on this side. I myself cannot see. Okay. So in that case, you have to do the lasso loop. And how do you do the lasso loop? So you take this bite and most of you who do, you know what is a lasso loop. So you pull this, create a loop of suture, and then put your instrument back again. But for this, you need something like a sixter or a clever hook kind of a device. You create a loop and through the loop, you go again and pull the suture. Like this. And then pull the suture inside. Now it creates a cinch. It's a very strong knot. So if you feel that my tissue quality is not very good, use a lasso loop technique. It's an excellent technique. Only thing is that here you have to use a non-sliding knot. Okay, you can't use a sliding knot anymore. And right next to this here, you can see this was the subscap area. Okay. It's the same patient which we saw the knot shift, but top I felt that it was not very good. So I use this. You look at this. If you have this repair on day one, tensioned IGHL, lifted up capsule, good, juicy, you know, the labral repair, this is the best you can do. And beyond that, if it recurs, it's God's wish. Okay. So other technique is a Mason Allen technique. Okay. Now, some people say, should I put the, you know, the horizontal or should I put the simple suture? Technically, it does not make a difference. Horizontal has got one advantage that it does not have a cheese wire effect. So again, if you feel that my tissue quality is not very good or patient is poor. So if your patient is poor, what you can do, you can use two anchors, but all doubly loaded. All doubly loaded and put all mattress bite. You will have a huge area of suturing. The only problem is it tends kinds of bunches, but still you can minimize your expenses. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vivek sir. It was an amazing and thorough presentation of the technique, sir. We learned a lot from this. Now I would like to ask our panelists if they had any questions. Please raise your hands if you have any questions, even the presenters if they want to contribute in any way, sir. Anything to add? Anything differently? Naveen sir, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Vivek, Naveen sir, then Chakra sir.
Vivek, you talked about the slap lesion. So nowadays, how frequently you get this slap lesion you come across where you have to repair in traumatic cases?
Typical slap lesion, probably when we are talking about the Snyder's, when it is, you know, just on the either side of the biceps root, it is, you can say, probably 1 or 2 in 100. That rare it has become, because we all realize that we were over-diagnosed. At one point of time, all of us have been guilty of slightly over-repairing it. But over the years, we realize that it doesn't happen very frequent. But lesions are there, but they are more posterior and superior rather than the typical type 2. But yes, I would say overall, okay, even if you say they're less than 10%.
Okay, you talked about various sutures like simple, mattress, Mason Allen, and loop, lasso loop. So out of them, what you suggest the best, which one is the best type of suture to go ahead?
You see, majority of the time, inferiorly, where we start the first one, usually the labrum and the tissue quality is good. Because if it is not good, if it is very poor inferiorly, then your entire setup may fail. In that case, as somebody was already suggesting, in that case, like Karthik was saying, sometimes you might have to switch over to Letage. Okay. So it is usually not the problem with the inferior most. Its problem starts with the second and third anchor. Okay. So if you feel that my anchor, the quality is not very good, labrum is thin, one, you can do the mattress. Two, you can do Mason Allen. Third, you can do lasso loop. I don't think I have any biomechanical great data to support to say this, but by and large, all three will do well. Do what you can do best at that moment. And easily.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. Chakra, sir, quickly, sir, and then we move ahead with the last presentation.
Thank you very much. It's a great presentation, good video demonstration. I just want to ask you one important point is, since the Bankart problem is anterior inferior and middle glenohumeral ligament issues, and then I have seen in your presentation, you have placed about 3 or 4 suture anchors, is that correct? 3 or 4 suture anchors?
3 anchors.
Yeah, so the point is, since our Asian population, like in India, Nepal, you know, our glenoid is a little bit longitudinally shorter than Europeans, do you think we can get away with the stability with just 2 suture anchor, and you have done a double loaded suture anchor, is that correct? You did that?
Yes.
So, like a single loaded suture anchor or one double loaded, putting one inferior, anterior inferior, and one middle glenohumeral ligament issue. Why I'm asking you is 2 reasons. One is the cost factor. Second is if we can address the most inferior and middle part, then we don't need to put the 3 double-loaded suture anchor and minimizing the cost. What's your opinion?
I agree with you completely, sir. So that's what I said. Number one, that is my preference, and not many would do this, but my preference is usually I put the inferior one double-loaded. Now, cost difference between single-loaded and double-loaded is usually 1,500, usually, because they charge only the suture cost. Okay. So that's what I said. Sometimes in some cases when you feel, one, the lesion is not very extensive, 2, patient may have some cost concern. So you can use 2 double loaded anchors, because with 2 double loaded anchors, you get 1, 2, 4 bites. Okay. But if you use 2 single loaded anchor, then either you convert the single loaded anchor into mattress bites. Okay. Then you get 4 bites. Otherwise you have to just put 2 bites. Now my concern, Pandesa, has always been one. You see, patients are the most finicky characters on the earth. If something happens in future, they'll say, oh, you never told me. I could have given this. Okay, so best is, if there is any cost concern, best is to use two double loaded anchors and give maximum bites. Okay, but just putting two anchors, I'm a bit scared, because most of the time, even with, because mine and your circumstances are not different, sir. You know, we are, none of them are us, are European population. Okay, I mean, European countries where you got a lot of money. So, but in general, I give them a quotation of three. Sometimes they are really down, then I say, okay, two double loaded. And you can manage very well. Yes, and there are some papers, but I would never say that loan reliance or single double loaded, single anchor double loaded could be a bit dangerous. Because if it recurs, now he'll come and chew you. He'll say, no, you could have done it that time only. That's the reason, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Rajiv Gupta, sir.
I also use double loaded, first one double loaded, rest of single loaded, or maybe double loaded. But now we have all suture anchors also. They are cheaper and very true. Half-hearted surgery is always, you are not supposed to do. If you are going to put a good bank card repair, at least two anchor minimum with double loaded.
Actually, there's a paper by Yap Williams where they have done the meta-analysis and they found if the anchors are less than three, though I don't completely agree, but they said if the anchors are less than three, because in their series, they had only simple bites. They said the chance of recurrence is high. And this wisdom was given to me by patient only. I had operated one single road repair patient in 2011, which failed at, you know, in a year's time. So he asked me to do something. I said, okay, we'll revise. So I said, okay, how do you revise? I said, okay, we'll do the double row repair. He said, what's double row? I explained him. He said, why you did not do first time? I said, it will cost you more. He said, see, now I have to pay everything more. So last time you finished in 60,000. Now you'll be, I have to pay, you know, 80,000. That time you could have added just one more anchor. And he's just very ordinary fellow. He's not a rich fellow. And that told me that I am no one to decide. I must explain him, let him take a call. So since then, my practice has slightly changed. That patient gave me wisdom that something happens, they just say, you could have done it last time only.
And related to this, my question to you, for this financial constrained patients, don't you like the first go advise them Latarge?
No, Rajiv, once in a while, I agree to you, Rajiv, I have done that. But you know, when you sit across the table and you talk to them, you know, first you always talk in terms of science to them. If somebody says, I've got nothing, doc, he is terribly poor, and he says, no, I cannot afford, he's a laborer, and those situations are only with manual laborer. And Karthik was very well explaining that. Who has to do a lot of overhead activity? Okay, fine, fair enough, go with Latarge. But there is a population, when you talk to them, they say, okay, you do arthroscopy now. I agree with you. I'll arrange the money somehow. So first, I think the science should come. If they completely fail on that behalf, they say, no, for me, economics is more important. Yes, Latarge is an option. I agree with you.
I agree.
We are moving ahead of time, sir. So quickly, Rajiv sir and Amit sir, and then we start with the final presentation, sir. It's already 4:20. So Amit sir doesn't have. Rajiv sir, you wanted to add something, and then we move ahead with your presentation. That is Latarge.
With double loaded anchor, the point contact is same. Most of the time, you tie the knot. Both the knots are hardly 1 millimeter apart. So with having all single anchor, why not use two anchor?
Knots are about 5 to 7 millimeter apart, but I agree. Finally, they may bunch up. Yes, that because this is how it is. But at least you get more bites. Actually, one more thing, Rajiv. Once it happened once, maybe twice in so many years that my one of the suture broke.
Yes.
Okay. Now, if it breaks, you always feel, oh, at least I've got one there, one extra there.
So it's the salvage here.
Yes.
Well, thank you, Vivek, sir, for clearing the queries. Now, Rajiv, sir, please.
Yeah, the last talk, and I think we have discussed lots about Latarge, and as I would like to, a lot of junior friends are there. So Latarge is not only the answer, especially for financially patient who can't afford also, because there are lots of complications of Latarge also. But yes, in some cases, when you have a bipolar lesion with the humeral head bone loss, the glenoid bone loss, having a glenoid bone loss of more than 40% like that, in such cases, you don't have any option. And I think the only way out is Latarge, the bony procedure. So that has been good. And if you see the follow-up in French literature, 20 or 30 years follow-up results are quite good. So when you are getting a patient with a bone loss, a financial constraint patient, a patient having a bipolar lesion, I think lethargy is one of the best option. And I do it in an open manner. Now I do it in a minimum open manner. So my position is a big chair position. It's a typical dentopectoral approach. The incision over the center of the coracoid, 2 cm above and 4 cm below. So go for a sharp dissection of the subcutaneous tissue. You can see here. And once you dissect the subcutaneous tissue, try to find the deltopectoral group. You can see the fibers of the deltoid and fibers of the pectoralis major and identify the deltopectoral group. Try to identify the cephalic band. You can ligate it or you can retract it either way. And develop the interval with a blunt dissection. Sometimes you may use a scissor or you may use a finger to develop an interval between the deltopectoral group. Now put your detector at the inferior part of the incision and one detector at the superior part of the incision for better exposure. And once you have identified your deltopectoral group, go gently deep and try to locate your coracoid. You can see a bumpy structure with a shining tendon up, and that is your coracoid. So once you have identified your coracoid, go with a gauze. You can just have a clearance of soft tissue of the coracoid. And now put your detector in the superior aspect. You can see there is a, you can see, and the first step is identification of the CA ligament and try to cut the CA ligament at least 1.5 to 2 cm from the tip of the coracoid, because that will help in you repairing the capsule. Here you can see I'm cutting it at least 2 cm from the tip of the coracoid, and the best way to cut the coracoid is angle saw blade. Try to use the angle saw blade and always cut from medial to lateral, not from lateral to medial, because there's a chance of injury of the muscular cutaneous nerve. Use a bristle or an osteotome to lift the coracoid once you have done your osteotomy. And try to be very gentle in this procedure, because medially you have a muscular cutaneous nerve, and with a towel clip or a cocker forceps, hold your coracoid properly. Now try to release the pectoralis minor and soft tissue, some soft tissue attachment around the coracoid, and you can see gradually once you try, you release the soft tissue around the coracoid, you can get the whole of the coracoid, whole of the bone of coracoid bone is there with the conjoint tendon. And be very gentle, don't try to damage the conjoint tendon, because that will have a sling effect. That will have a sling effect. So now after this comes the preparation of your coracoid. Try to remove this soft tissue from the undersurface of the coracoid. You can see there are some fatty tissues and soft tissues are there. Try to remove those soft tissue. And either you can use a nibbler, you can use a saw, or you can use a burr to make the undersurface of the coracoid, to remove the cortical bone from the undersurface of the coracoid. You can see here, I'm using a burr here. By burr, you can just remove the under, this is a dental burr by which you can just remove, decorticate the undersurface of the coracoid. So once you have decorticated the undersurface of the coracoid, this is the coracoid holder, and you get it with the arthrex set and try to make your two holes. And normally these two holes are 5 to 6 millimeter apart, and always put your protector on the underneath the drill. Now once you have made the hole, I always mark the proximal, the superior aspect of the hole with my diathermy, so that I will not lose this hole once this is, I will put it over the glenoid. And now just, this is the, you can see concentric guide, which is there, which comes with the arthrex set, and that is very helpful. I will show you later on how it's helpful in putting the coracoid in the ideal position. Now this is the second part. Now you have to split the subscapularis. Subscapularis should be ideally at the upper two-third and the lower one-third junction. I think the video is running well.
Yes, sir.
So split the subscapularis. Be very gentle at the upper two-third and lower one-third junction. So once you have split the subscapularis, go gently downward, because that is your way for the glenohumeral joint. And you can enter your glenohumeral joint. So gradually try to lift the upper part and the lower part. Try to put your blunt retractor in the glenohumeral joint and one for the retractor over the superior and inferior. And now the other detector over the superior part of the glenohumeral joint. And this is a blunt dissection. Always use a blunt retractor, otherwise you may damage the cartilage. And once you have done, now try to make a capsulotomy. Normally I give a vertical capsulotomy. Sometimes I make it a L-type capsulotomy, the last shoulder. So here it's a small shoulder, so vertical capsulotomy will do. put your retractor between the superior and inferior border of the splitted subscapularis, cut the capsule properly, and now you can see this is the way for towards the glenohumeral jet. Yes, I can see the glenoid, and this is the humeral head retractor, very good instrument. Ask your assistant to give an abduction strain, and you can retract whole of your humeral head. You can see this is my humeral head and this is my glenoid, and you have detected both with the humeral head retractor, whole of the humeral head. And always keep a threaded keyboard, because you don't try to put retractor in superior aspect. So like calcaneum, I put a threaded keyboard in superior aspect of the glenoid and try to expose my try to lift my superior aspect of the subaspect. And the fourth important step is the preparation of the glenoid. Try to remove the soft tissue from the anterior and inferior aspect of the glenoid. Again, you can use the dental burr to remove the decorticate some amount of bone from the anterior and inferior part of the glenoid. And the next step is insertion of your graft. Now, this is the use of your concentric guide, and it has two holes in the proximal part. And the only advantage is that once you put it over the surface of the glenoid, your graft is 1 to 2 millimeter lateral to your glenoid margin, which is very important, because if it is towards the glenoid, there will be impingement of the graft with the humeral head while having rotational and abduction adduction movement. Now, pass your two guide pin over this concentric, and at this time, be very gentle. See, you have to feel the second cortex. You can't see the posterior cortex of the glenoid. Be very gentle and pass your two guide wire. Now I have passed my two guide wire over that with a cannulated drill bit. I will drill first the inferior and then the superior ear. And you can see now my graft is fixed with the guide wire. At this time, now try to drill it and be gentle, because again, you have to palpate the first cortex, the second cortex very gently, because you have your suprascapular nerve posteriorly. So try to. So once I have drilled, now use your titanium screw. Don't use washer. Don't use washer. Measure your anteroposterior length, because you have detected whole of the glenoid head, and insert the screw. And insert the screw. Don't try to over tighten it. Just tighten it. Once it you see yes, it is tightening. Leave it like that. And now you put your second drill your second superior drill guide and put a screw in the superior part of your coracoid graft. Again, it's a cannulated drill bit. Feel the first cortex, feel the second cortex, and tighten your superior screw. Now you can see both the screw has been tightened, and you can see here the graft is almost 2 millimeter posterior to the anterior rim of the anterior inferior rim of the glenoid. So it should not overhang over the glenoid, because that will have an impingement over the humeral. If you leave it like that, there will be an impingement over the humeral head. Now remove your guide wire, and after removal of the guide wire, go for a final tightening with a normal screwdriver. And you can see here, now I am giving a final tightening with both the superior and the inferior screw. The second fifth important step is the closure of the capsule. The CL ligament, the remnant of the CL ligament, 1.5 to 2 centimeter of the CL ligament should be repaired with the capsule. Normally, I use a non-observable suture to repair the CL ligament and the remnant of the capsule. So once you have repaired the CL ligament, now you have to close the subscapularis. Normally, I put a observable suture, one or two observable suture in the subscapularis. It's a split there. Sometimes recommended, don't put any suture. Sometimes in some paper, they said, yes, put it, because it gives extra stability. You have splitted it, you have retracted it. So I put two or three non-observable suture. And see, this repair of the subscapularis is good or not. After you've done your subscapularis repair, the second part is closure of the deltopectoral group. Again, I use a non-observable suture for closure of the deltopectoral group. And once you have closed the deltopectoral group, you can put your subcutaneous siege and skin siege. So why it is important, and what is the advantage of doing a LATAR jet? As we, it was discussed by Karthik also. It has three benefits. First, it's a bone block. Second, it is increasing the anterior posterior diameter of the glenoid. Third, it has a sling effect. And definitely, you are doing a capsular reinforcement also. So these are the three important features of LATAR jet, which has make it a very successful operation in indicated cases. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajiv sir. It was a very elaborative and informative presentation on LATAR jet, sir. Now I would like to ask, since Chakra sir has already left because of his meeting, the rest of the panelists and presenters, if you have anything to chip it in, please go ahead, sir. Naveen sir, we start with you.
Congratulations, Rajiv. Very nice presentation as usual. I just wanted to know, when you are doing a lethargy procedure, then already there is a bony avulsion thing is there. Do you use some extra anchor or things first to fix that very bony part, or you incorporate in the same graft that you are taking from the coracoid?
If I am dealing with a bony bankart, I would like to divide that part of the bone and put the graft there also. Recommended to remove the part of the capsular labral tissue and the bony part. If you have a small bony bankart lesion, remove that part. Okay. But that did not work yet. So anchor with Latarget, I think it's not recommended.
Okay, another thing I want to ask, nowadays the Americans talk about the congruent graft. So any idea about that, what they want to say, and the reports of that?
If you see the Bristow procedure, they were putting the coracoid like this and the Latarget, it was parallel like this. All right. So the congruent graft, they tell that normally coracoid, what happens is, if you try to sit in the anterior and inferior parts, it's very difficult. You see, there are some amount of water hanging there in the inferior part. So they try to match it with the shape of the glenoid. So some of the authors suggest that iliac crest graft is best than the coracoid graft, because the congruency is better than the coracoid graft. But you will not get the sling effect in iliac crest.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, Arjun Lamichani, sir, you wanted to ask something. Kindly unmute yourself and ask the panelists and even Rajiv, sir. What were your query? Arjun, sir? Arjun Lamichani, sir?
Okay.
And then we have an interesting question from Amit, sir, which he has posted in chat. We would want to ask that too. Arjun sir, now, meanwhile Arjun Lamichani sir is unmuting. Amit sir, you were asking about capsular repair. You wanted all the panelists to say, do everybody do capsular repair or not, right sir? Amit sir, unmute.
Yeah, so how important, the question is, how important is the, because this the step of repairing capsule with acromion ligament is sometimes it's very tricky and difficult. So how important it is, this step, and how many of us we routinely do that?
Can I answer that?
Yes. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so as you said, sometimes it's not easy at all, and in fact Jill Walsh himself doesn't do it often. It's not a very important step here. So as we understand, Jill Walsh himself, when we talk about or ask him about the mechanism of how the Latarge works, it's not very clear. Though we say there is a sling effect, there is a bone block effect, there is a capsular repair effect, we still really don't know how the Latarge surgery exactly works. And according to him, you repair or don't repair doesn't matter. You repair the capsule, don't repair it, doesn't matter at all. Some people like Pascal Bolo, they put an anchor and they do a proper bankart repair along with the Latarge. They make the graft extra articular. Again, there is no theory that it is any better at all, but they seem to do it routinely. But when the same person does it arthroscopically, they cut the capsule and throw it away. When you do arthro Latarge, you can't do anything to the capsule. You actually leave it. So when you do only open, all this is passed.
Dr. Vivek, you okay.
I think, as Karthik very rightly said, that actually it does not make a great difference. You can always try to do all these things, but there are some tips and tricks. One more thing, you see, when you reach there, okay, now you have split the subscap, you see the capsule, and you make the T-shaped incision. When you reach actually the glenoid, often your labrum is already gone and you have to put your periosteum elevator. Once you put periosteum elevator, all your labrum is already gone. It is nowhere there. So it has always baffled me, what do these people actually repair? Because often you have to remove the labrum, you have to freshen the whole area. You have to put such a bone block, and it's hard to keep the labrum above the glenoid, then you do it below. Okay, that is point number one. So it has always baffled me, probably only once I could, save the labrum, otherwise labrum goes away. Second thing, if you really want to do that in your experiment, when you cut the CA ligament, I'll give you the tip. Before you cut you expose it properly, before you cut, you run the, you know, you put the running baseball sutures right in the beginning. Okay. So you put the running baseball suture and after that you cut them. Now, once your coracoid is gone back inside, that running baseball suture also helps, you know, identifying where is my coracoid still. When you go inside, when you are splitting the capsule, if the minute you have split, you put the two sutures at these two apex. So you got the apex, you put the two suture right in the beginning. Okay. And then leave them apart. You put your Galpi's attractor, retract, put your bone block, fix the screw. Now you have got two sutures, identifying sutures for capsule. Very easy. You can just close them. Because once your graft is in the place, overlying the subscap, the inferior part of capsule is not at all seen. You can see only if you have an identifying suture right in the beginning. And with the same suture, you can put the, you know, sutures, tie the sutures of your, you know, the remaining part of CA ligament. One problem happens with this little tail of CA ligament, which is attached with the coracoid. I have found myself, the problem is, this is the coracoid and this is the CA ligament. It often comes in the vision between you and the glenoid. So you are scared that are you placing your glenoid a bit lateral or medial? That is the reason I gave up. It is not because of the technical difficulty. Right in front, you have the CA ligament and it becomes very difficult to see the glenoid. As it is, that place is a crazy place. And once you get the love of arthroscopy, na, you start hating these open latages anyway. It's okay.
And I Arjun, sir. Yes, sir. Arjun, sir. Yes.
But yes, you okay. Thank you, Dr. Rajiv Gupta, Dr. Rajiv Raman, Dr. Vivek, Amit, and Dr. Karthik for the excellent presentation. I have some query on remplissage. As I had written a question, and Dr. Rajiv had given an answer also. But in a heavy patient, it may be difficult to avoid taking the deltoid while taking a remplissage. Now, what are the other tricks? Like, is Dr. Rajiv Gupta said he withdraws the posterior cannula and then passes the take the suture. But in many instances, like you, many people, they do without putting any posterior cannula also. One question. And another question is there any difference in the outcome whether you take infraspinatus or teres minor, either tenodesis or sometimes myodesis?
Any of the presenters, sir, please take the question.
Sorry, the question was whether we take the infra or the teres, isn't it?
Yeah.
So it doesn't really matter, sir. As long as you stay lateral, if you don't go too medial with your bite, as long as you stay lateral, basically the Hill-Sack lesion extends from superior to inferior. So if you see, it is a posterosuperiorly located lesion. So posterosuperiorly, you will actually get only infra. But sometimes if there is a multiple hit, there is a huge Hill-Sack, then it might extend all the way down up to your bar area. Then you might include some teres also. Doesn't really matter. Actually, as long as you just take a bite laterally and stay a little lateral, close to the footprint of the cuff, then you will not actually restrict the movement of the patient much. So it doesn't really matter. Have I answered the question or was it?
Yeah. What about any tricks to avoid taking deltoid?
Yeah, so that's the scariest part when you actually start. So what I do actually is I make the posterolateral. So I view from the anterosuperior portal, I make a posterolateral portal for taking the bites. So my anchor comes through the posterior portal. Posterior portal has a cannula already. So through the cannula, I put the anchor. But I take the bite from the posterolateral portal. With the posterolateral portal, I actually put a cannula, make sure my cannula goes all the way through the deltoid, but does not pierce the capsule. So I can feel the cannula onto my posterior capsule. So I keep the cannula there and then pass my bird beak through that. So now I know that my bite hasn't taken any deltoid. So once I've done that, finally at the time of suture tying, I pass both the sutures of the same color through the knot pusher and push the knot pusher onto the humeral head. Make sure it is not giving me a soft feeling. Make sure that I'm hitting hard on the humeral head at the back. So when I'm sure that I'm hitting the humeral head, not anything very soft, that means that I'm not through the deltoid. I'm through the both my sutures are through the cuff only, and the deltoid is bypassed. So that's how I make sure. So in a blind manner, you still can bypass the deltoid.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. If we don't have any question, yes, Arjun sir, please.
Yes. You are talking about that either tenodesis or myodesis. Is it possible like to avoid myodesis by changing the rotation of the arm also? Like if you external rotate, you can go bit toward the tendon side?
Yes, that is that has been suggested in literature, but I think it's very difficult that because it's a blind procedure, you are doing a tenodesis or myodesis. As suggested by Dr. Vivek and Rajiv also, try to be over the center of the defect, and a bit of 20 degree or 30 degree of external rotation will help you go for a tenodesis rather than going for a myodesis.
Take the bite laterally. If you take the bite medially, you will have the muscle. So when you take the bite, when you pass your bird beak, don't go close to the glenoid. Go close to the humeral head.
Yeah.
Okay. Naveen sir, yes. One last, and then we take three interesting questions from the chat, which Dr. Vivek Basukala is asking, and then we finally close, sir. Naveen sir, quickly, sir.
Usually, sometimes we come across the patients like maybe 25 year, 30 year, who is having a multi-ligaments instability, Bighton's maybe 7, and he wants to go for sports, or maybe regular sports. MRI, no Bankart or Hillside thing was not there. Just a big capsule and hyperlaxity. So which procedure is it? Just go and do the capsular repair or go for lateral jar, which will maybe start from Vivek can give. Hyperlaxity patients wants to go to sports and the recurrent dislocation, maybe more than 100 times.
The plan will never change just because somebody has got hyperlaxity, because with the plan remains the same.
Dr. Vivek, he does not have any Bankart or Hill-Sack on the MRI. That's what Dr. Naveen says.
Oh, I think I missed that part. Okay. Oh.
Yeah, there are paper also the laxity of the patient doesn't affect on the outcome of the shoulder surgery.
No, we see, are we talking about, you know, complete Embry model? You see, there are patients who have, you know, if you see the Stanmore's classification, so you have the traumatic instabilities with structural lesion, and then you have got the only muscle patterning, but then you have got atraumatic, there's no trauma, they have laxity, but if you carefully evaluate through the investigation, MRI, you will find a structural lesion. Now, our experience is, if there is a structural lesion, okay, if there is some Bankart lesion, some small little spring, they usually do, if they have a spell, they do well with the, I know that labral lesion repair, you can do some more plication. Rarely, you can also close the rotator interval. But if you're talking about a pure Embry patient, there's no lesion anywhere, he's just lax, and some of them, if you actually push, they can subluxate also. I will not operate them. I don't know. You know, you can try all this, you know, the global plication, but the chance of recurrence remains very high. Karthik, you have any answer for that?
Yeah, so if there is no structural lesion, so Dr. Naveen, you are saying that there is no structural lesion in this patient, isn't it?
No.
And what is the predominant direction of dislocation for him?
Yeah, he does anterior dislocation.
So he always dislocates anteriorly. So on examination, he has a 9x9 Bighton. That's what you're saying.
Not 7x9.
And his shoulder is very hyperlax. Gages is positive. Right. So this is a patient whom you have to rehab. Rehab.
Rehab been done many times. I tried to refuse the surgery. Then again, he comes. And many times rehab sentence, then what is the choice?
Okay. So in this patient, he's not a voluntary dislocator, right? He's not a voluntary dislocator.
Not voluntary
dislocator. Okay. So this patient, you have to make him understand that you can do a capsular plication. So you can do a 180 degree capsular plication for him. But then you have to make him understand that the surgery is not the final fix for him. The rehab is not working because of the capsular hyperlaxity. Though you have strengthened his core, his scapular muscles very well, his scapula is all perfectly okay. There is no scapular discinesis, but still if he is dislocating, then you have to tell him that his day in the operation theater is again first day of rehab. So we are actually doing a capsular plication, but if he doesn't rehab again, he will again fail. So after the capsular plication, then the shoulders proprioception is in place now. Now the shoulders proprioception has come back to its normalcy because the capsular laxity is reduced. So now you can rehab him better. But again, he has to rehab before going into any sport.
Okay, thank you.
Second important thing is, Naveen, counsel this patient because that is very important. Tell them that you are not the right person for going to sports. Everyone cannot become a sports person.
That's true.
Okay, thank you.
So we move with three interesting questions. Vivek, you can ask it to the presenters now. Three questions, okay, only three questions, and then we close.
Okay, most of the questions which are asked in the chat have been answered by our panelists, and many of them have been covered in their discussion. So my question is to Rajiv Raman, sir. Sir, in our set of patients, many of times what happens when we harvest the coracoid graft, it comes very small. And how to bail out in such conditions? We should resort to keeping only one screw or get something else.
So if you have a very small coracoid here, so you can put only one screw. See, normally the distance between two screws should be 5 to 6 millimeters. If it is very small graft, you can come out with a single screw.
But what is a very small graft?
Yes, sir?
What is very small graft?
Small length, the very small length
coracoid. I think you have done for superior osteotomy, I think, from the neck of the coracoid like that.
Yes.
So I think sometimes you can manage 20 is, I mean, we have never failed to get 20. Only there are some studies, maybe sometimes if you are really in doubt, you can always, you know, maybe do the CT beforehand. If you feel that you have got only this much, which is absolutely insignificant, then always keep this iliac crest in the consent, always. That in case if it happens, as Raju said, you can try fixing with one because the original procedure was only with one.
One, yeah, that one.
Can you decrease the size of the screw also, like 3.5 or so?
Definitely. You can go for a smaller screw size.
Yes.
So as Dr. Vivek said, the size of the graft usually is about 20. We've done a study on patients. We found that most of the time we're able. So the trick is to go all the way back. So where you position your foeman, and then how you harvest the graft. I just use a osteotome. I don't use any fancy saw. Just put your foeman at the back and then use a sort of 1-inch curved osteotome. You'll be able to most of the time get up to 20 mm.
Yeah.
If you harvest this.
Karthik said, foeman is the key.
Yeah.
You know, you really have to retract and you have to really see. And best is always take the scale. You know, those scales come in that flexible scale. Cut it at around 22. Cut the scale at around 22 to 23 and put it from the tip and see that how far you can go without damaging the coracohumeral these ligaments. Okay, sorry, coracoclavicular ligaments. Okay, that will tell you that how far you have gone. And Karthik very rightly said, sometimes the scare, you know, am I going there? You put your scale, you see. That's the best thing. And then you mark with a cautery and then you start take the curved osteotome and curve it and you will get it. It's very rare, you know, that you get a very small. 20 is very reasonable.
Yeah, if you really end up with a small graft, then you can actually do a Bristow. Bristow is basically, as Dr. Rajiv Raman said, it's only the tip of the coracoid. And they just fix it with one screw. So it can
Can I just interfere here?
Yeah.
What is the what happens if it is the opposite side? You know, like you bring out a long coracoid, but you find that the glenoid, anterior glenoid margin, you're not sure. Do you have a specific measure where you put anterior indifferently up to which? I don't see that has been specified. Or do you have any practical tips on that to how far to go inferiorly into the anterior border of the labrum and how far you can go superiorly? Yeah. If you get a long coracoid graft, is there any measures to, you know?
Yeah.
Rajiv, you can answer.
If you see, this is your glenoid. You can see it should start from ideally 2 o'clock or 2-3 o'clock position like that, and it should go downward. Sometimes you may have overlap in the inferior part, but that hardly matters. Don't need to be because that part you are having a conjoint tendon also. So start from 2 o'clock
anterior and inferior part. I think that is the part we have to cover. Normally, we try to cover that part.
Amit sir, I
just wanted to say why this graph becomes small is because you use a straight saw and then you don't have an exposure right going up to the back of the coracoid. You know, if you are not able to go to the back of the coracoid, probably you'll get a short coracoid. So if you don't have a 90 degree curved saw, probably it's wise to use an osteotome, curved osteotome, so that you can go right behind that one. Most of the time, many of us, we don't have that 90 degree angle saw. So what we do is we use a straight saw. And in doing your straight saw, you may have a possibility of having a very small cut. That's it.
Okay. Vivek, next question.
And, next question is again to Rajiv, sir. We have known from today's lecture that the critical bone loss for to differentiate from arthroscopic Bankart to Laterge is 20%. So when is the condition, what is the percentage of bone loss that even Laterge cannot cover? Is there something like that?
Even Laterge can?
Even Laterge cannot cover.
Your maximum bone loss which you would use for.
That Laterge can bear.
Oh yeah. If it is more than 20, it's not 20% as Karthik told. Now the literature is supporting up to 10% also you can go for bony procedure if indicated. All right. So if it is more than 30% bone loss, I think better not to go for Laterge, go for iliac crest bone grafting. That will be a viable procedure rather than planning for a Laterge. If it is more than 40%, 30 to 40%, better go for iliac crest graft.
Any other presenters with different opinions, sir? Vivek, sir, Rajiv, sir, Amit, sir.
More than 40%, Vivek. Dr. Vivek, what is your option? Whether you will go for a Laterge or you will go for a iliac crest?
No, I think I'll go with the iliac crest only. Up to 30% is okay, but more than 35, first of all, I have not seen. In my entire life, I have not seen one patient with 40% bone.
I have also not seen. It's very theoretical. Yeah.
I have seen one patient with 40% bone loss, young fellow. And I did a Laterge only because I thought, you know, iliac crest, you don't have the conjoint tendon. So here the main effect comes from the conjoint tendon. So
these group, Karthik, can sometime coming from epileptics. You know, yes, epileptics have huge bone losses. I also have one which has got about 30-32% they have measured. And Karthik said very valid thing. What you can do is see from 45 with the coracoid, you may build up to a condition where you will have the glenoid deficient by, let's say, 5%. Okay, but a dynamic effect. So can be tried, but these numbers are so less to say that what will be the exact outcome, but yes, can be tried.
Vivek, last question. Arjun sir's question is going to be the last one.
My query, I'm not aware of this. Do you have any condition, any events that you have to do Remplissaz plus Bankart?
Oh, I have done, twice. How it happened actually, that I went inside and I elevated the capsule. I felt it was not nice. Mm-hmm. The LZX was large, so I put the anchors. When I came back again, I kept on palpating with this thing. I said, God, it is bad here. And they were all active people. Then, I said, okay, even if I repair, put three anchors, do heroics, what if it recurs? But by the time I had finished the health sacks. Okay. So then I thought, okay, let's leave it and let's do the Laterge. So the health sacks remplissage happened by chance and not by choice alone. It was not a planned thing. I did that, I thinking that I will be able to manage. But by the time I did everything, somehow my heart didn't allow to go ahead. So I had to do the Laterge.
Anybody other?
So I think, Dr. Vivek, it is an overkilling of putting a Laterge with remplissage.
No, that's what I said, Raju.
So it is a literature.
No. See, it is literature very well, and now there are revision, revision failure of, bony procedure. You can do iliac crest with remplissage. Okay. And there is another one, this thing coming that in a failed Laterge, you can do Bankart repair, which is always I have thought, plus remplissage. Yeah. All sort of things are coming. But I agree. you know, whether it is overkill
and very or what, but selected indications, I think very rare indications.
I had just done it by chance, you know, I did it.
Yeah.
And I thought this capsule is bad. So I thought, okay, leave it and do letargy, not by choice.
So I have done two cases. That was a neglected anterior dislocation of shoulder. So as per these patients had a huge heel sac lesions. And I didn't want to do a bone graft at the back. So I did a small mini incision at the back, detached and medialized the cuff insertion into the heel sac lesion. Anteriorly, for reduction, I had to do a coracoid osteotomy. So I did a letage and then added an open remplissage. So I've done two patients, both are doing well. So this was a 6 month old neglected dislocation, anterior dislocation. This is not a like a, not for a, any straightforward case. It is like a open McLaurin, reverse of McLaurin. Yes, yes.
Okay, so I guess we are done with it, sir. So any thing else? I would like our president of Arthroscopy Society in Nepal, Dr. Isur Pradhan, and then followed by Arjun Lamichhane, sir, to close the session. And we would also want some good feedbacks or any kind of feedbacks which in any ways we can improve our presentations and these webinars from our presenters. Some few words. We start with our presidents.
Okay, thank you, Nagmani. It's been a very, very nice, you know, very elaborative, very discussive, you know, presentation. And thank you all our eminent speakers from India to giving us the time and, you know, pouring your knowledge, your expertise. Thanks, Vivek, for your nice demonstration of Vanguard, Rajiv for your letterage, and Dr. Rajiv and Dr. Karthik for their very meaningful insight into the basics, you know, basic as well as the complicated things. Well, we really have overshoot the time. You know, we were supposed to finish by 2 hours, and we are nearing 3 hours. I congratulate my younger guys, my Amit, Nagmani, and Vivek to taking up this step to, you know, make our academic, which could not be physically done, but this is a boon, you know, at least we get to see our friends' faces from time to time. This is better than being in prison. But I do hope when the lockdown goes down and we can invite you all in presence here. So thank you. Thank you very much, all my friends.
Thank you very much.
All the panelists.
Thank you.
From the,
sometimes I think, I think that, you know, yes, you know, the face mask, but if you look at it, you know, in 2 hours, I mean, you know, sometimes happens whole day you sit in a conference, whole day, and you realize, hey, what did I learn here? Oh, I learned, I liked only three presentations. Okay. And for that, you would have started from Nepal, killed your 1 day up, 1 day down.
Yes.
2 days.
Yes.
4 days
that
you
is
stay.
Why...
4 days you stay and you say, okay, I learned only this much. Yeah. Okay. And so, yeah, these meetings are really sometimes nice, and you know, yes.
This is future.
Yes.
This is going to stay. Yeah.
This is going to be future and cost effective also. Cost effective.
Yes. Definitely. I quite agree. This is
time saving, cost effective.
You're not leaving your practice.
This is a boon in disguise, because we knew there are things going on like this, but it has really come to our field also, and we have realized that. I really thank you. And of course, I have to thank my country delegates, you know, panelists who have also given up their time. Thank you, Chandra. Thank you, Naveen. Thank you, Dr. Pandey has already left, and Dr. Arjun also. Okay. Okay. I hand over my stage now to Dr. Arjun now. He wants to say something.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Isur. Really, as you said, this coronavirus and this lockdown has been blessing in disguise to some extent, because this is the first experience I have had, and I thought it's not less than the actual live presentations and discussions that what we do in abroad and in countries, even on sitting at home, talking, exchanging knowledge and getting things this way is really commendable. Thank you very much, Dr. Vivek, Dr. Rajiv Raman, Dr. Rajiv Gupta. We had met long back, around 2-3 years back or so, in Jaipur, 2 years back.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I remembered, and really we had nice time.
Yeah, Dr. Karthik, and then all taking this initiative by Dr. Amit and his team, and all Nepalese, our friends, colleagues. Without audience and questions, any conference and interaction is not possible. So thank you, everybody. I think
we
continue this till this lockdown remain like that. And even after that also, if we could manage some time, this can be managed in any leisure time if somebody can give their time at home. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Presenters, presenters. Amit sir, you want to say some last word? And we are not seeing Karthik sir, his video. We are not.
Karthik, please.
I wanted to thank all the faculties, especially Rajiv Raman, Vivek, Dr. Rajiv Gupta, and the Karthik, sparing such time and teaching us, because we are learning shoulder arthroscopy. And to tell you very frankly, this was amazing, as Vivek said, that we haven't learned this much. We have been part of so many conferences, but the learning that we got in 2.5 hours is amazing. And thank you very much. And be available to us. You are good today, friend of us for future also.
Today, I'm going to get beaten by Roshan Vade. I didn't realize. And I gave the timing to him also.
I saw your name in academy meeting. I thought, how you will manage?
I didn't realize. I just overlooked the time. I thought it's at 5 or 6. So when he called me, I said, "Oh God, now abhi to mere ko pitai hogi."
Abhi webinar ka calendar banana hoga, Vivek sir.
I didn't realize that.
They are watching webinar from India also. Yes. It's not
Karthik, Karthik, Rajiv, anything you want to say? Any suggestions?
Thank you very much for the kind invitation. Fantastic. Long time back. Really loved the place. It was a beautiful city. Went to the temple. Really loved the whole thing. And I've had some good friends in Kathmandu in this wonderful way of meeting all of you. Thanks very much for the invite. And we'll see you again soon sometime.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, Rajiv, what to say?
Dr. Amit, it was a really nice experience. And really, this type of webinar, short meetings, is going to be there. Because real learning, because now meetings are getting bigger and bigger, and the interaction is getting less and less. And of course, we enjoyed a lot. Thanks a lot. Thanks for invitation. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, everybody. Ciao. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.